world gone insane. An upside-down civilization cannot be real. A world of madness and terror.
It's the Dana Gould Hour.
Today's show is brought to you by Casper. Get $50 towards any mattress purchase by visiting casper.com/Dana and using the promo code Dana at checkout. Terms and conditions apply. And if you ever meet me, please don't slash Dana. This is something of a different episode of the show. It's dedicated, almost in its entirety, to one man, one topic, a brilliant writer and a brilliant radio performer named Joe Frank. Joe Frank started his career, by and large, at WBAI in New York and eventually made his way to KCRW in Los Angeles. He was completely unique. He was incredibly inventive and is actually the reason that this podcast exists. And I will explain why in a moment. But first, let's do a little business. Fans of me, and if you're listening to this podcast, I assume you are probably mildly interested in what else I'm up to. You can avail yourselves of my live coast-to-coast joke-telling show from March 1st to March 4th at the Good Ol' Improv in Irvine, California. Now, I know, to most of you, Irvine, California is known only as the filming location for the opening credits and the slave auction scenes in Conquest of the Planet of the Apes. But no, it is so much more. It is the home of the University of California at Irvine, the Irvine Comedy Club, the Improv, and possibly some homes and other businesses. My apologies to all of my fans up in Tacoma, Washington. I was supposed to be there March 8th, 9th, and 10th. But regrettably, I had to reschedule due to an acting commitment that I was signed up for that got moved around, and I had to honor that, as I'd already been paid and cashed the check. But I hope everyone up there understands, and I look forward to rebooking that, assuming they'll have me. I'm a big fan of Washington State, and not just for your delicious, delicious apples. March 22nd, 23rd, and 24th, I will be in Bloomington, Indiana, site of the Little 500, performing at the Comedy Attic, one of my favorite clubs, and I will be joined at that show by our own Valerie Tosse, a previous guest on this very podcast. April, come she will find me back in Austin, Texas at the Moon Tower Comedy Fest and up in Lincoln, Oregon, but we'll get to those dates in good time. Can't get out to those gigs? Why not pick up my album, Mr. Funny Man, available at iTunes or directly from my website, danagould.com, where you will find not only information on the aforementioned live appearance dates, but also, in our library, convenient links to any and all movies, books, and what have you mentioned here on the show. That's the library page of danagould.com. You can also find Bevel Aqua heating and air conditioning t-shirts and a host of other products at our store at comedyfilmnerds.com. But this is the web address we're concentrating on this month. Get out a pen. JoeFrank.com. JoeFrank.com. Now, several years ago, when the podcast boom started, people would often come up to me and ask, hey, why aren't you doing a podcast? You really need to do a podcast. And it took me a while to get on the train because I didn't have an idea that I thought made it worth having a podcast. I didn't want to do my crappy version of Mark Maron's great podcast. I didn't want to do my crappy version of Chris Hardwick's great podcast. So I just kind of sat it out until I had an idea that I felt justified having a show. And I thought about, eventually, a guy named Joe Frank. Joe Frank had a show on KCRW, on National Public Radio, called In the Dark, when I first moved to Los Angeles. And what Joe Frank would do would tell these incredibly hypnotic, fascinating monologues. He had this rich voice, and he was a brilliant writer, and he would tell these stories that would start off simply and then grow more and more complex. And underneath them, he would play these rhythmic music loops that would just draw you in. And it was one of those shows that if you were listening to it and you were almost done with what you were doing in the car, you would just keep driving because you had to get to the end of it. And then the more I got hooked into him, he did a lot of other stuff. He would write little mini plays where he had friends of his performing stuff that he had written. He would record phone calls. It was fascinating, but it was never cheap. It was never shitty. It was always brilliant. But I was really hooked into the music loops of it. And I thought, well, what if I could do a version of what he does, but with conversations, where I could record a conversation and then cut it into segments the way Joe Frank would cut a monologue into segments and then put music underneath it. And then I thought, well, what if I did it with more than one conversation? So it was sort of like you were auditing two conversations at a party, going back and forth and back and forth. And then for the music, I chose bongos because I wanted it to sound like a radio show that you would listen to in 1966. I wanted it to have a sort of tiki theme, a mid-century theme, which I am a big fan of. And eventually it moved into becoming its own thing, but the jumping off point was Joe Frank. And without him, I don't know if I would have come up with a good idea. Sadly, Mr. Frank passed away on January of this year. He was only 79. He leaves a legacy of an amazing body of work, and I cannot recommend it strongly enough. And it is all available to you at joefrank.com. Now, during this show, I'm going to be talking to our own Eddie Pepitone, another big fan of Joe's work. Eddie heard him when he was first on BAI in New York. And Dave Carlson, who wrote and directed the documentary Joe Frank, Somewhere Out There. And you can learn everything about that at joefrankmovie.com. Now, I'm not getting a dime off of any of this. I'm just a fan. And if you enjoy what I do, I think you'd really dig it. So I'm trying to help you cool cats to some wow new sounds. Anyone who listens to public radio knows that they have to suffer through pledge drives, where all normal programming stops and the on-air talent asks you to contribute and underwrite the station. Los Angeles's KCRW is no exception, but when Joe Frank was on the air, he was allowed to put his own spin on it, and I'm going to play that for you now, and then we'll get into the show itself. There will be no middle piece on this show. There will be no two guys from Boston, although both will be back next month. In between the interviews, I'm going to be interspersing some of my favorite monologues from Joe. It's about 0.00000001% of what he is capable of doing and what he has available. But hopefully it will whet your appetite enough to go to joefrank.com and joefrankmovie.com and take a bigger bite. At the end of this episode, we are going to present a 30-minute piece from Joe's show In the Dark that dates back to 1993. It's a piece that I wrote and performed and that Joe Frank produced. I really want to thank Farley Ziegler, Dave Carlson, and Logan at joefrank.com for all of their help in getting access to these pieces and making them available, and most importantly to Michael Story, who gave her kind permission for them to be presented here. I really appreciate it. So anyway, it's a hot summer's day. You're in your car. You're listening to NPR. And this pledge break comes on.
Hello.
Hi, I'm looking for Jenny.
This is Jenny.
Hi, Jenny. It's Matt Holzman calling from KCRW.
Oh, hello.
How are you?
Good.
Thank you so much for supporting KCRW.
Thank you.
I saw that you became an angel. You gave us a dollar a day.
Yes.
And you took 3,500 frequent flyer miles on American Airlines?
Yes.
Is your premium? You're planning on going somewhere?
Yes.
But you're a first-time subscriber.
I am.
You've been listening for a while?
Uh-huh.
But you finally decided to take the plunge and become a member. What are the programs that you listen to the most?
Oh, I love This American Life. And Selected Shorts. I have another call. Could you just hold on just for a minute?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Hello?
Jenny?
Yes?
I'm
sorry. You know, God...
Are you all right?
No.
Come on. No. Hey, honey, come on.
Leave me alone.
Jesus.
Oh,
come on, take it.
Hello?
Hi. It's Matt Holzman from KCRW.
Uh-huh.
You know what? It sounds like a bad time. Maybe I'll call back in a bit.
What do you want? Is this about her sister? Or?
No, no, no. Jenny subscribed to KCRW, and she won our Angel Sweepstakes to Hawaii. She won 5 nights at the Kapalua Bay Hotel, including an ocean view room and a complimentary scuba class, and Hoffman Travel is going to fly you both there.
This is outrageous. How dare you call at a time like this? Is absolutely obscene. We have a tragedy in this family at this moment. Do you understand that?
Yes,
my sister-in-law has died. She's died, and there's a lot of confusion.
I'm so sorry.
I can't possibly deal with this kind of thing. Would you just shut up for a minute, please? Would you just put a sock in it, for God's sake? I'm dealing with somebody on the phone. We want a trip. I'm trying to work it out. After the funeral, maybe we'll go. Would you shut up? I'm on the phone, for God's sake. You're whining. Hey, hold on. Just hold on 1 second. Just hold on 1 second. I'm telling you. I'm getting... just stop. Shut up. You shut up. You shut up. I told you to shut up. Right now, damn you. Damn you. We want a trip somewhere, for God's sake. Are you still there?
Yeah.
Are you still there?
Yes.
Will you just hold on a minute, will you please?
Yeah.
You just hang on the line.
Hey, listen to me. She was half gone in the first place. Your whole family's half gone. Would you just give me the 1 minute, please? Just 1 minute. Calm down. You're going to be all right. Yeah.
Sir?
Yeah.
Is Jenny an employee of KCRW or Santa Monica College? Or the Kapalua Bay Hotel or Hoffman Travel?
No, not at all. Not at all.
And can we use some portion of this conversation on the air?
What's that? I can't hear you.
Can we use some portion of this conversation?
Hey, would you just take it down and go back in the bathroom, for God's sake? I'm trying to get some info. I'm sorry. Please, excuse me. What'd you say?
Can we use some portion of this conversation on the air?
Oh, sure. Yeah.
Okay. Well, congratulations.
Hey, thanks a lot. Hey, can I ask you something?
Sure.
Is there any kind of rerouting or rebooking this flight, you know, because we got to go out to the Midwest?
Well,
is that possible?
Yeah, you can talk to the people at Hoffman Travel, and they might be able to help you out.
All right, great. Hold on, just one. Hey, would you please shut up? No! I told you 1,000 times! I don't care about it! I never liked her anyway! You're making me sick! I'm talking to this guy! My God, we're going on a trip! We're going on a vacation!
It's a beautiful winter day high atop the Mulholland View shelf here in Falcon's Lair Recording Studios. It's February. It's sunny. It's dipped into the temperatures, dipping down into the 70s. We're two grown men drinking coffee. That's what this is.
Mm-mm.
If this was 1971 and we were my aunts, we would have beehive hairdos. We would be smoking a pack of Kents and working our way through a coffee cake right now. I'm joined by Eddie Pepitone.
Good evening on this chilly. Actually, Dana, I just want to correct you on one thing. It's in the upper 60s.
Oh, is it the upper 60s?
So
Jesus.
For people who think LA people don't suffer during the winter.
Yeah, they'd have no idea.
Think again.
Yeah.
Think again. I mean, I thought about putting on a hoodie.
I saw a homeless person rub his upper arm four times.
Okay. I'll go.
That's an up and down gesture for one. Up, down, up, down, up, down. And then one more. He was that cold.
I thought about blowing into my hand early this morning. And that's how cold it was. I thought about it and then I didn't need to do it.
Some days in Atlanta, this is Kevin Rooney once described being outside in Tempe, Arizona in the summer as opening an oven door to check on a chicken pot pie. Just that blast of dry heat.
Ugh.
And Atlanta is, during the summer, is like opening a dishwasher mid-cycle to check. And this is like opening a fridge for 3 seconds. Just, just the faintest memory of a chill in the air.
Yeah, yeah.
We're talking, this is sort of a special episode of the show, by and large about one topic, but obviously we'll go all over the place.
Oh, we'll riff around from chocolate to Mao Zedong to, you know, whatever.
The smell of stale chocolate.
The expanding universe.
But we were both talking about how much we love Joe Frank.
Yes.
And I first got into him here in L.A. when I moved to L.A. in like, had it been 91, he came on KCRW. Which is the public radio station here in Los Angeles. But you knew him from New York.
Yes, I knew him.
WBAI?
It might have been BAI, yeah. But it was an amazing thing because it sort of was like one of those kid things of like discovering something, coming across a gem, like sort of like, you know, when you...
I know exactly what you're talking about. Yeah,
yeah, but like in Staten Island, it's really highlighted because you're surrounded by coal. You know what I mean? And you're digging in the coal mine and you're like, well, you know, I don't know. There's a couple of good things on TV. But what was really cool about Joe Frank, there was no YouTube. There were no computers back then, I don't think. And it was just, I came across this on radio.
Yeah, which is not supposed to be challenging. You know?
But, you know, just to like go back and forth between present and back then is that I've been watching some of them on YouTube the last couple of days, and I just find them more hypnotic audio.
I can't describe the way it has an effect. I don't think anybody, he was so ahead of his time. Like he was doing stuff in the late 80s and early 90s that people now would go, you play it for people now and they can't get over it. The only other, there being in Los Angeles in the early 90s, my memory of it is when I lived here, I moved here in 1989. My memories of it is being really hot. I lived in where I lived
in LA. It was hot.
Well, I lived in San Francisco for 2 years prior to that.
Very
and I
cool.
lived, well, I lived in the Richmond district. I lived at 21st and Geary, which, and I used to
name
do,
dropper,
not to brag, but I used to do a bit about how one time I remember driving up from Los Angeles. I was down here and I drove home and it was a cloudless sky.
Right.
For 5.5 hours.
Right.
And then I crossed 19th Avenue in San Francisco, and it became a gray fog bank. Like the sun
was it always not, like that over there?
Always, because it was down by the ocean. The sun did not – my apartment had never been touched by sunlight. It was like druids hauling stone tablets across the street. It was
you were in an episode of Dark Shadows.
It really was. It was so gray and misty all the time. And then I moved to L.A., and it was just blasting heat all the time, which I loved. And I remember being in my car, stumbling upon Joe Frank. And he would play
While you were driving?
While I was driving. First time I ever heard him. And he would play, and people will hear it on this podcast. We're going to play a couple of selects. These loops, these music loops that were so hypnotic and that would drag you. And his voice was so chocolatey, for lack of a better term. And he would take his time, and then slowly, after about 10 or 15 minutes,
He's what? What?
He did one story and about a guy that had had a midlife crisis, and he decided to climb Mount Everest with a group of other guys. And it goes on, and very specific stuff about the ascent of Everest and the risks involved. And then one guy stops at a base camp and opens a gift shop.
Well, here's the thing, you know.
But that came like 15 minutes into the story.
Well, he is an amazing, and I guess people who don't know him, and you'll play him some clips and they'll get to know him, but he is this mix of like absurdism, surrealism, but, and this is what I love about him, and I realize he's a kindred soul, is like it's rooted in this deep, I think, emotional upset.
Totally.
Like he is working stuff out.
Yes. Well, he had a brutal childhood. He was born with two club feet.
Oh, really?
He was 5.5 years old, and he had surgery to correct his club feet. The day of his surgery, his father died. Oh. And his mother didn't tell him right away. And he had health problems all of his life. I think he had, he was born with one testicle undescended, and then the one that descended got cancer.
Oh, wow.
And he had to go through cobalt treatments on his nut.
He always had health problems.
Always had major health problems. But what's also amazing is he had these health problems, but he was also like a really handsome guy.
Yeah, he was handsome.
He was a really like good-looking dude.
Yeah.
And would tell these and he sort of stumbled and I think he just got he had a sense of irony. People that grow up who get the sense that they're lucky to be alive early in their life have a sense of ironic detachment that other people don't have. Another example of somebody like that, John F. Kennedy, who was on death's door multiple times as a child. And
right.
It just gives you this sort of like, uh-huh, yep. Like it is hard.
His stories would have been, if he became a Joe Frank guy with that heavy Boston accent.
Oh, that would have been great.
And decided to open up a gift shop at the base of
That was one of my earlier that's funny you say that because one of my bits from that period of time when I first moved here was
late 80s
late early 80s 90s? Or very early 90s the 89 90 91 was a JFK with that voice would have made a very interesting comedian. Man goes into a party, he forgets his wallet there. He wakes up the next morning and all he can remember about the party is it had a red door and a gold toilet seat. He gets into his car and drives around town and knocks on every red door. Finally, at the last house, he finds his wallet and the man says, "You were so drunk at that party. How do you remember my house?" And he said, "I remembered your red door and your gold toilet seat." And the man said, "You're the guy who pooped in my tuba."
But with Kennedy's like weight and that voice, the joke would always end with, "And let that be a lesson to you." These jokes have points. Like he still has a presidential feel about him.
That would be an amazing way to end every joke. "And let that be a lesson to you."
"These jokes are to be used for the greater good." like he's still presidential with the jokes. "Pass these jokes around to a neighbor. These are hard times."
There's a really brilliant documentary that was just completed that I just saw about Joe Frank and his work called Somewhere Out There. And it was created by a really talented independent filmmaker from Chicago. And he's with us today, Dave Carlson.
This is the sound of my voice.
Hi, Dave. How are you?
I'm doing fantastic. Thank you.
You're in Chicago and I'm here at Falcon's Lair Recording Studios high atop the Mulholland Drive view shelf in Southern California. And that's just the beauty of technology.
That's right. It's 30 degrees where I am, and it's probably 70 where you are.
Maybe a little hotter, but Look, my daughter's dog dug up one of my plants today out back, so it's not like I don't have my own struggle. So I have been doing a lot of going back through my Joe Frank-ania recently. And it is amazing where I think the best way to describe him is that you've never heard of him, but you've heard of everyone who's is a fan of his. It's sort of like not everybody saw the Velvet Underground, but everyone who saw them started a band. And he reminds me something along those lines. Where did you first come into contact with Joe? Do you go all the way back to New York?
Going back to about 1988, I was living in Chicago still, and going to school, and he used to pop up on WBEZ in Chicago here, the public radio, and he was sort of back-to-back with Ken Nordine, mm-hmm. because Word Jazz. So we had it great here. I think it was Sunday nights. They would do it like 11 at night and then midnight. That's where I first got immersed in him. And then it wasn't until, I think about 2003, he was at the Third Coast Audio Festival getting an award for a lifetime achievement. And that's when I sort of put a call into him and his wife, Michael, to see if I could go out and document the performance. That was the first time I met him. They agreed to do that. And I went out there and I met him through when he was doing a rehearsal for the show, the live show he was doing that night. And that was sort of my first time I was with him face to face.
Was that the same show that he did at Largo?
No, that was later. This one was in Chicago at the Art Institute of Chicago. It was great. He had Ed Valfrey, a trumpet player, horn player, and Tara Hughes, I think her name was a dancer, and they did sort of a performance piece with Joe speaking on stage. I was creeping around during the rehearsal, sort of setting the cameras up and feeling things out, and I'd asked Michael, his wife, if I could maybe interview him, and it was sort of like, I don't know, he doesn't really do on-camera interviews, but he eventually did. He came around and he sat down with me and we started talking about stuff on camera, which I guess was pretty rare for him. And then I filmed the show that night and cut together sort of a piece that I called No Applause, Joe Frank. And it never really went anywhere. Joe kind of didn't want it to get out, one of those things. So it was just sort of sitting there for a while. And then it wasn't until a few years later when he came back to Steppenwolf that, started off this production.
That story says a lot about Joe Frank. Also in the way in that he's not as known as he should be, and no one was a bigger obstacle to that than him. he seemed obsessively careful about his exposure and what went out. I mean, he was real in that regard. I mean, he was a real artist. I guess the question is, did he wish he was more known, or did he not really care?
I think the people that I talked to, it's somewhere in between. I think he liked to do things his way, but I think he also probably wished it was easier to do it, or he had bigger opportunities to do it. I don't know. I mean, I had not a whole lot of conversations with him about that in particular, but I just know directors that try to license his stuff over the years or develop things in Hollywood, and they never really came to fruition. But thankfully, this film did. I mean, it took me a while to, I think, get his trust, once we got rolling on the thing and shooting it, because he can be kind of an intimidating guy,
How so?
Well, he's exceptionally well-read, and he's a director of his own, in terms of the creative process and knowing how to put things together.
Yeah, he was a tall guy. He was a good-looking guy. He definitely had a presence.
Yeah, absolutely. And, I was just a Midwestern guy sticking around Chicago with, an associate's degree education who, used to dig graves before he went to film school. So
now I play a grave digger on television.
Oh, you do?
I do. I don't want to brag.
Well, it's a great job. Nobody talks back.
Yeah, exactly. It's my one skill, digging. Did you find that? Because I know that when I wanted to put this episode together, I talked to Michael. Michael is his wife. It's a woman with the name Michael. And I'm a dude with the name Dana. So there you go. And, there's hundreds of episodes of his work. And I said I wanted to excerpt some things. And she gave me, a list of 30 pieces that he okayed. Like, this was all he wanted out, so to speak.
Wow.
I just thought that was really fascinating for somebody to like go back through their own catalog and chuck most of it. That was really fascinating.
Yeah. Well, with my film, I interviewed, just to start with that part, I interviewed like 33 people that were all part of his sort of world. But I was looking at the numbers earlier today. I think I pulled 55 selects from his 200 plus shows that got into the film. And that's a real challenge because, his work's pretty diverse, and And when I was studying this stuff over the years and listening to, you know, going to my kids' soccer practices and just listening to Joe Frank for an hour and looking like some freak on the sideline, I noticed that to get through an arc of his stories, you know, which would fill out an hour, it usually took about 7 minutes to get a beginning, middle, and an end. Then he'd shift gears, 7 more minutes. And so the challenge with the film, of course, is like not just trying to visualize his shows, but also trying to find the arcs that I need between the narrative, you know, because, you know, I'd love to run a 7 minutes of Joe Frank, you know, but that ain't going to fly on the big screen. So it was trying to find the 90 seconds or, you know, the minute or the minute and a half, if I could stretch it, where you could get a beginning, middle, and end of something and then move on with the narrative. But there's a lot of stuff there. I mean, it's 200 plus shows that he did over nearly 40 years.
Yeah, and he would take his time. I was listening to, I think, White Moon last night, and that's a 57-minute monologue. That's hard to excerpt. And it is also tricky for you as a filmmaker to do a movie about a largely oral, A-U-R-A-L, experience. The brilliant thing about Joe Frank is it's a completely intimate experience. It's not like, that's why I think it was very strange to see him at Largo.
Mm-hmm.
Because in Los Angeles, 9 times out of 10, you're alone in your car with this voice, and it would take you places. I was playing some of his work for my girlfriend in the car, and you'd start into a conversation about something as you're driving, and I would have to stop it. Like, no, we can't. It needs all of your attention.
Right. I mean, since this film's been, you know, out, so to speak, in the fall when I started officially getting it out there and people know it's out there, I get tons of emails from people through the website, and they all have the car story, you know, and they're all very intense. I have to tell you, and with all due respect, you know, I have to tell you, you know, when I first heard Joe Frank, it was in a car and I couldn't get out of the car. You know, it's like, welcome to the club.
Yeah, that was my first story too, in Los Angeles, driving around, probably 1991. I was in my Honda Civic hatchback, brown with tan interior. I lived in the Mid-Wilshire behind what is now the Peterson Auto Museum. And I was driving around. I'm like, what in the name of Christ is this? And I got home and just, nope, I skipped driving. Like, well, I'm done, but I'm going to keep driving. And a lot of that is a part of the music, because his early stuff in New York and BAI, his work evolved. You know, he started as a regular DJ, and then was 80 Yard Run his first major piece?
Yeah, 80 Yard Run, I see. That would be 1978. Then he followed it with a thing called Jewish Blues and the Death of Trotsky, stuff like that. But yeah, that stuff was more panel driven. You know, there were other character actors around. He would do his monologues, but he'd also intersperse it with these sort of panel driven things. We talk a bit about that in the film, but that's where he's working with like Arthur Miller and Tim Jerome.
Not the Arthur Miller, we should say.
Correct.
Not Marilyn Monroe's ex-husband.
That's right. And then one of his best friends, Lester Navsker. So those guys were part of that sort of group that would come to WBAI and work with him.
When he was out here on KCRW, does that pay the rent?
I don't know about that. I mean, I imagine when he got invited out there, he got some maybe salary. I don't know the details on that, you know, but I think he self-financed a lot of his work. His dad was a German industrialist who came from right before World War II started, I think. He was a shoemaker. And I think maybe some of the money that he had to work with came from that. I mean, he was an only child, so that might be part of it. But yeah, he was definitely one of these guys that did not pay the bills. I think he did a lot of, you know, like an independent filmmaker would, you know, a lot of his own self-financing, get his work out there.
I always wondered, like, how those people, but how do you get milk? I have friends. I'm like, how do you pay the rent, dude? I don't know if you have friends like that.
Well, I have what are called corporate clients. You know, I have the independent film stuff that looks really great and sounds really interesting to people like you. But then on the side, when I'm not doing that stuff, then I have, you know, the money making stuff.
How batteries work.
Yeah.
Let me tell you the truth. Joe Frank is a character that I created, who I pretend to be. But I'm not really Joe Frank. My life doesn't even remotely resemble Joe Frank's. Yet, what I'm saying now, the admission that I am not Joe Frank, has been written for me by Joe Frank. So my position here is paradoxical. It's as though I were saying to you, I do not speak English.
in perfect English. I'm not free to speak my mind as I would wish, and yet, at the same time, having said that, I was only expressing Joe Frank's views. My views, you will never know. And he wrote that line, too. So, please understand that whatever I say during this evening's radio show has nothing to do with me personally, and as much as I may want to say something else, as much as I might even detest the character I've been shackled with and would like to reveal to you the truth of my life, I am bound by the constraints of my profession, which means that whatever words I just uttered, including the words I am speaking right now, are not really my own, but those of Joe Frank. So, now I'm going to tell you what I really think. I think this radio show is a tasteless, posturing, vacuous piece of audio farce. I'm truly ashamed to be a part of it. I believe it marks a low point in my career. And the only reason I took this role was that a film job years ago fell through. And yet, these are exactly the words I've memorized for this evening's performance, because they are in the script, and I am professionally bound to say them, no matter how stupid I think they are, no matter how poorly they reflect on Joe Frank, who wrote them. A man, incidentally, who is paying for this production out of his own pocket, because no one else would dare mount it, except him. Now, although I believe in the Stanislavski method, and therefore I am Joe Frank, and will forever be Joe Frank, let me repeat that I am nothing like him. I could never do the things Joe Frank says he does. But of course, I might do them, since everything I'm saying and have said has absolutely nothing to do with who I am in the real world. Or, well, never mind.
But I remember, like, being in L.A., my little apartment on Allendale Avenue, and driving around. And then I stumbled upon Joe Frank. And it was a really interesting time because yeah. It was – people forget – like, now that, you know, it's time has gone by and the 80s are looked back as this great era. Like, Reagan was Jesus and yeah. Everything was great. I mean, the 80s were a horrible decade. You know, there was
– I'm trying to remember.
Clothes were for shit. The hairstyles were for shit. There's a lot of great music.
There was a lot of great
music. Not the music that you, that like the typical 80s crap, but like the, you know, the alternative music in the 80s that I, you know, you had a lot of great stuff. And the early 90s, the George H.W. Bush presidency from, 93 to, 90 to 93 whatever
the first Bush
That was very much the hangover of the 80s. That was it was just this kind of a sour time, and it was at the first Gulf War, and the 80s was so glossy and fun. And the 90s, the weird shit started to bubble up, and the time that I'm talking about, like, first discovered Joe Frank, Twin Peaks, the original good Twin Peaks was just coming on. And, you know, I was like starting this new thing, and it was like, I was in LA and like, wow, there's all this great stuff. And it just means so much when you find something that rings your bell like that.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. That was my experience with Joe Frank, you know, living in the, the culturally challenged enclave of Staten Island. You know what I mean? Because
which is like Berlin in the 20s. Staten Island in the 80s was Berlin in the 20s, to be sure.
Yeah. But I was just the thing about Joe Frank's work is that, like, and what I love about it and what I love about art in general is that it just opens you up to the possibilities of anything, because that's the way his works kind of were. Like just the way you described a little bit of that, you know, guys are ascending Everest and then all of a sudden someone opens a gift shop. And I love that.
Yeah.
Because it's sort of that surrealism,
yeah,
where it's like, oh, this doesn't, as an artist, I loved it because it was like, oh, this doesn't have to go linear. It doesn't have to be like, no, they have to go all the way up to Everest. And then, you know,
yeah,
it's like, no, many things can happen the way, yet we can still be rooted to this reality of this expedition.
Totally. There's a, in the pilot of Twin Peaks, you know, we're watching it and, you know, we're all watching it with a bunch of people, mm-hmm, and they find the dead body. And then suddenly, the Jack Nance's character is talking on the phone, mm-hmm, and he has a cup of coffee and he spits it out and he goes, "Don't drink that coffee. There was a fish in the percolator."
Yeah.
And everybody's like, "What? What?" And it was like, oh,
I wonder if it would be interesting.
And I still get that when I see something that takes a chance and it mixes a genre, and I get so happy. The me Shape too. Of Water made me so happy. Just like, oh, a guy made a Creature from the Black Lagoon movie with fucking in it. This is fantastic.
Yes!
My friend called it Grinding Nemo.
Oh, that's the best.
Yeah, Mike Mendez.
That's the best I've heard.
Mm-hmm. Or Fishy Shades of Grey.
But yeah, I mean, and even when I'm doing stand-up, not to drop my own name, but even when I'm doing...
You should say when Eddie Pepitone does stand-up.
When Eddie Pepitone...
Like Trump, when Trump does stand-up.
This reminds me of something Eddie Pepitone did. No,
this is what I find. When I'm doing stand-up and I'm really hitting all cylinders and I'm being as good as I can be,
yeah,
I see in the face the joy that you only see from like Melania Trump. Just that look of effervescent joy that she always has radiating out of her. No, she always looks like she's sitting on a toilet and she feels a rat coming out of the water. You know?
Do you think her entire inner monologue is, what have I done? What have I done?
She is the poster child for seller's remorse. I do wonder if she will kill him in his sleep.
Could be.
It could be. Donald was very upset. I don't know what she talks like because I don't think she's ever spoken, but I'm doing her as...
How long is she?
I'm doing her as Zsa Zsa Gabor. Donald was very upset.
She never speaks.
So he stabbed himself 21 times.
Isn't she running... Like Michelle Obama did all these things. Like, did you know, was the head of all these programs. Is Melania not doing any kind of program?
So. But
like,
she,
how to make origami or anything? Like,
I think she, you know...
How to pop a zit?
She... no. And it's so funny that people are nice to her because they can, you can see when someone's dying inside.
Yes.
You know, there's like,
yes,
the motion picture camera.
I have people come running up to me on the street. You okay?
But she does. You just look at her and like, that's an unhappy person.
Yeah.
And I don't have any sympathy for it. It's like, well, you married him. But it's very, people don't make fun of it because everybody's just like, yeah,
I know.
She's suffered enough.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly. You don't need me. Yeah. You don't need me. But somebody said it is nice to know that we finally have a first lady that you know has had cocaine blown into her asshole with a straw.
Oh my God. I would
look of joy.
I actually, it would be so interesting to hear Joe Frank do something on the Trumps. You know, that would go.
His last works. I don't know if he completed his last works or not. I'll have to check. As the old song goes, you don't know what you got till it's gone. You're like, you know, I was such a fan, but then when I heard he died, I was like, no, I could have gone to his house. Like a good guy. That's like, what? No.
Yeah.
You know, it's really frustrating.
When did he start putting, or when did his stuff start going out on the airwaves? Do you remember? Was it around when you found him?
Well, I think he moved. Well, I mean, he was very big in New York and BAI. Then he got hired.
That's when I heard him.
And that was about what time?
I'm not
mid-80s?
Sure.
Mid-80s?
Yeah, yeah. I think it was mid-80s before you.
Yeah,
you
know. Totally, yeah.
And I heard him before you is what I wanted to get across to people.
You're better than me. You're better than me. That's not a point at issue. The Comedy Store. Is that where you work out?
The Comedy Store.
That sounds like a good place to do comedy. I bet a person of my imprimatur, a person of my career level, I could just call up and say I want to come down and do a set.
I think they're a little full up right now. But,
oh, you think so? Really?
And it's not because of your skill level.
It's not because of your 35-year career. We just brought in 24 people from Flappers. So... then he went and was the weekend host of All Things Considered. And
he
Yeah. And that didn't work out. And then after he did All Things Considered, somehow he ended up in LA at KCRW, which was, apparently in the world of National Public Radio, KCRW was like the Sex Pistols.
Nick Harcourt.
Yeah.
With, what was it called? The Morning Becomes.
Morning Becomes Eclectic.
Or as some comedians said, I forget who it was, Morning Becomes Pretentious.
Yeah, it was, you know, and that was the miracle, because you'd be listening to public radio and it would be funny. I mean, on Sunday mornings, you had Le Show with Harry Shearer, which was excellent. And then you'd have Joe Frank. In the dark. So it was just amazing. But then, yeah, I did a lot of stuff. I did a show on NPR. I even forget the name of it. Mm-hmm. But I had to correct them because originally it was like, you know, their version of a comedy show is, what is comedy? Like, no. No, I'm not doing that. That's not what this is. Don't talk like this. I'm going to talk like this.
What is comedy? Why are we laughing so much?
Yeah. What is left? I literally, the ultimate NPR show, there was a show called Book Bag or Book Talk.
Book Talk, maybe.
Book Talk. And I was getting in the car and it turned it on and the guy goes, the book is Comfort Me with Apples.
Is that true?
That was the name of a book. Comfort Me with Apples. And I was just like, shut up! Like screaming at my radio, shut up! But then you'd find the show, you'd find In the Dark. Then later, Phil Hendry, who's still around, who's a genius, also a genius. And then the other amazing radio, like I can count on my hand like the things I've heard on radio that are great. And
yeah.
It was like Le Show, In the Dark, Phil Hendry, and After Dark with Art Bell during his heyday.
Art Bell. Is he the crazy?
Yeah, the guy from Pahrump, Nevada. And he's not on anymore.
UFO stuff.
Yeah.
And
he would have, Art Bell was a brilliant improviser because he had this belief that you would never say no. He would just never say no.
To anybody who called in?
No, whatever. And he would be like, hi Art, I'm a time traveler from Andromeda. I work at a Rite Aid in El Paso, Texas. Go ahead, sir. And I remember one time, again, like one of those, you turn on the radio and you hear something galvanizing. I had a shower radio.
Oh, you know, I remember them. I had that for a wet radio. They called it.
A wet radio. Yeah. And I was working at the show and The Simpsons, and I came home. It was a late night and I came home really late and I got in the shower and I went to take a shower before I went to bed and I turned on the radio and the first thing I hear is, sir, I'm not saying that you're not the Antichrist, but we had the Antichrist hotline open last week and I got 23 phone calls. But I'm not saying you're not the Antichrist. Just hear me out.
Oh my God.
When people ask you, what are you up to? And you say, I have this documentary I just completed. And you tell them the name of it, and they go, oh, who's that? What is it about? How do you describe to a novice Joe Frank and his work?
I always say, are you familiar with Dos Equis, the most interesting man in the world? And they all go, yeah. And I go, well, that sounds a lot like this piece that Joe did years ago called An Enterprising Man. You know, it was this sort of man who had a monologue and this deep voice, and he listed things of great achievement, and there was looped music in the background and a drone, and it was riveting. And they go, aha. I go, well, he's this guy who's on public radio for many years, 40 years or so, and he would tell these great monologues about the human condition. And usually 50% of the people know exactly who he is. And of those 50% less than 1% say, I don't like him. I know who he is. And the other 50, you have to sort of turn on to, you know, or at least fill them in a little bit more before they get it, or play them something. And they go, oh yeah, I've heard him before. Or they remember that he was on, you know, late night public radio in that pocket. Cause he played in Chicago for many, many years, you know, on the radio station here. I think his biggest audience outside of LA is definitely Chicago, followed by New York. So, people know him, but people who really know him don't forget him.
Absolutely. And what I find fascinating about him was that he could be so brutally funny and yet didn't flex that muscle all the time. Like normally people that are funny, they lead with that and they stick with that.
Yeah.
It seemed like he could take it or leave it, or he would wait 40 minutes into a piece to start and would just start to suddenly slide in bits.
Yeah.
And you'd sit up.
Yeah, absolutely. I think there's, and a lot of it's very surreal. I mean, it can get very wacky when he gets that funny bone going, you know. I think it's funny because when I was thinking about the shows that first turned me on, one of them was called Green Cadillac, which was a sort of a monologue, very screenplay sounding about a guy who buys a green Cadillac and all these bad things sort of happen to him. Prior to talking to you the other day, I said, yeah, I'm going to put that one on again and just sort of see why I like that one so much. And it turns out I don't like it at all right now. It was fine. It was good. There's some fun stuff in it. But what it was that I remember, I think that hooked me at an early age, so to speak, was the drone. It's mm-hmm. one of those ones that starts with the drone that a lot of his work did. And it just sort of you know, grabs you right away. And you're sort of stuck in this narrative through the whole thing. But I've always, just getting your point about the funny stuff, I've always liked the stuff that was really heavy duty monologues about the human condition and philosophy and things like that. And these listing of things. Those are things that I always gravitated to. And I think I did in my film too. It's like Joe at one point said, I'm funny. I do a lot of funny stuff. And I sort of had to go back into the catalog and with him and try to find some stuff to sort of intersperse it just to show that he had a little more variety. But you know, his personal story is so interesting and so dramatic. It's easy for me as a filmmaker to sort of go right for that stuff because it's easy, quite frankly, and fascinating, I think, for the viewer. And then just sort of build around it with the rest of his shows, you know, that showed all the different types of things he did.
Yeah. And that is sort of the point that I was making, that he could be so incredibly funny, but he would have to remind people that he could be funny because so much of his work were these other pieces that really did. I don't know how you would describe it. They were monologues, but their way they were delivered, he was almost like an audio collage artist. I mean, it was his own genre. I've never experienced anyone or anything that does exactly what he could do.
Yeah, I've heard people say recently, you know, like there's so much podcasting stuff going on now. It's like he blows most podcasts completely out of the water just in terms of content. And remember, when he was really cooking with gas in the 80s and 90s and 2000s, he was doing like a show a week, so to speak, at KCRW. Yeah. And a lot of that stuff started as analog, you know, so he was doing it on tape and flying it in at the last minute, literally, and going right on the air. And the amount of production value he put into each one of these shows in terms of sound design and the written word and the actors and everything he used, you know, it's an incredible amount of creativity.
It was like an hour long Joe Frank monologue was like seeing an amazing movie.
Mm-hmm, absolutely.
And it seemed to be that much time. Now, one of the things that he did that I learned in your documentary that was really fascinating is that he would tape record his friends without their knowing it when they were on the phone.
That's right.
tell the story about the show where he just called all of his ex-girlfriends.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's one of the ones that I don't have that one in the movie. But yeah, I think he called people and he called them at night, I think, like at midnight or 12 at night, kind of woke them up and he sang to them. Right.
Yeah.
Larry Block was another guy out in New York who he called a lot. And then Debbie Mae West in Venice, I think, is where she was at the time, or L.A. or something. Those are the two that really anchored that series he did called The Other Side. And those are where he really amassed a lot of phone calls and recordings to sort of revisit these two people's lives over the weeks and their different challenges they had with themselves.
Yeah, he had several shows on NPR. He had In the Dark, The Other Side, Somewhere Out There.
Work in Progress.
Work in Progress. Did he view each show as a different entity, or was that just packaging and marketing?
I think like all artists, that everybody kind of grows and evolves a little bit. So I never talked to him specifically about that. I think he probably did though. When you talk about, you know, Somewhere Out There and stuff like that, that's definitely stuff that's way more personal. Him reflecting on his own life, his own relationships, the stuff with Larry, the stuff with Debbie and others. That was definitely more, I wouldn't call it reality based, but in effect it was, you know, before people knew what that term meant.
Yeah. The day he tells a story about going on a date with Ariana Huffington.
Right.
that right. has to be true.
Yeah, it is true. It is true.
Here's what's amazing about him. He is this really tall, handsome guy like who, with this amazing talent who had the most brutal childhood, just health problems and recurring sicknesses and illnesses, and goes on this date with Arianna Huffington, and it's so humiliating.
That's right.
And he tells it with glee.
There's a other batch too of stuff when he used to teach at Dalton School in New York, you know, in Manhattan, before he went to WBAI and sort of started creating his shows. And I always liked the stories from Dalton where he was, I think he was an English teacher, and he would talk about having relationships with a kindergarten teacher and stuff like that. And he'd be in all these awkward situations with them. And then, the whole weight of, and I know this was part of why he wanted to get out of Dalton, the weight of seeing all the other parents come in who had stuff going on in their lives. And it made him look at himself and think like, well, I've got so much to offer. I want to sort of be like that too. And I think that was one of the reasons he broke out of there and started doing his shows. You know, he was sort of, couldn't handle, seeing everybody who were sort of successes in their own way.
Well, that's what he says in the film. And it's really fascinating because he's talking about his best friend, the musician.
Peter Green.
And he says, like, Peter is envious of me because I'm underground famous. I'm cult famous and I've got a following and I've got this cool career. But I'm envious of Peter because Peter's really lived.
That's right.
Expound upon that. Why didn't he feel like he had lived?
Well, I think his radio work took over that. We talked about it. He would work on these shows literally from the Monday till the time they aired on Saturday or Sunday or something like that. Maybe gave himself like a day off. So he was, what's called the studio rat. And I think a lot of that time in his probably 30s and 40s and stuff like that, he was just cranking out the shows. And he didn't take time to do what his friend Peter did, which was explore the world and have all these sort of experiential things. And that's sort of an important beat for me in the film. And when I first interviewed Joe for the film that never went anywhere called No Applause, that was something he offered up to me, was what we're talking about now. And I thought, how interesting. Here's a guy, when you listen to it, sounds like he's got so much going on and so much world experience, but in reality, it's not him. It's sort of like this other guy, Peter, and other people that he was living vicariously through. So when I returned to make the feature here, that was like an important scene, an important beat to get back to. And Peter, his childhood friend, is in the film too, talking about it. So
when that leads to one of my favorite monologues of his, which is, I am not Joe Frank. It's brilliant. And it's also sort of like the soundtrack to an existential crisis.
Right.
When you try to describe him to people, Spalding Gray comes up. Mm. And to me, he was like the bastard son of Spalding Gray and Phil Hendry almost, in terms of what he was able to accomplish. I don't know if you, did you have Phil Hendry in Chicago? Do you know Phil Hendry?
No, I don't know, but I can tell you in terms of that type of stuff, Joe was way into like Gene Shepard. That was a guy that I think he listened to as a kid. And that was one of his early inspirations, I think. But I know that type of storytelling, I think, really got him thinking about radio and stuff like that.
Well, it's the only place you can do that. What was his take on Garrison Keillor, outside of Garrison Keillor's apparently prodigious back rubbing ability that we know of now?
I do not have an answer to that. I don't know much about that.
Insights, the sheer scope and range of my knowledge, the synthesis of my intellect as it ranges over a wide field of topics, able to discuss the manufacture of extruded molybdenum, various schools of Japanese sword making under the Taranga shogunate, the tempered scale before Bach, the history of aniline dyes, North African leather curing techniques, and subatomic particles attendant to the cluster of black holes, as postulated by Hawking. Is it because I'm a world-class expert in bioluminescence and have developed my own species of fluorescent porcupines? All I know is that my presence in a room is electrifying. I can see desire burning hotly like coals in people's eyes when they look at me. I can see them undressing me, the smoldering gazes of women compulsively crossing and uncrossing their legs, men grinding their molars while sweat forms in hot beads on their brows, and teenage girls digging their nails into the palms of their hands, their lips parted, their eyes wet with desire. I was a perfect Renaissance painting of a baby with pearly white teeth, creamy peach-colored skin, hands and feet perfectly formed. My ears were small shells, my lips a red flower. My face recalled cherubim, the most beautiful of choiring angels. Next to me, all the other children looked plain, awkward, ugly, overpowered by the radiance of my physical beauty. A number of them actually committed suicide. The notes they left behind mentioned me by name. They said, I can never be as beautiful as Joe. I can never be as perfectly realized as Joe. There's no point in living. The other day, in a restaurant, a woman rose and, as if in a trance, stumbled her way, losing a shoe, to my table. Then she fell down on her knees in front of me and, grasping my waist, hugged me, her hot tears wetting the bottom of my shirt, then asked me to just touch her face. In the supermarket, I was at the counter when the checkout girl, looking at me, her pupils going wide and then up into her skull, fainted dead away. And when I went to the cleaners to pick up my clothes, the woman behind the counter said she couldn't find them. But I was told by her 14-year-old nephew that she, in fact, had taken them home and was keeping them for some votive or religious purpose. The last time I took a cab, the driver refused to let me out and drove me around back streets and freeways just for the pleasure of looking at me in the rearview mirror, never stopping anywhere until he ran out of gas. And when I climbed out of his cab, he pursued me, clutching at my clothes. The other day I went to a copy center and was set upon by a number of women who, blouses and brassieres pulled off, skirts hiked around their waists and pantyhose pulled down, tore off my clothes and carried me to the Xerox machine where they held me down against the glass in order to make multiple reproductions of my face, the undersides of my hands and feet, my buttocks, the soft under portion of my arms, the crook of my elbow, and the flesh behind my ears. Can you imagine how humiliating this was? It's impossible for anyone who hasn't lived in my skin to realize the moment-by-moment agony that I suffer on a daily basis.
Career Beauty School will help you fulfill your ambition of becoming a beautician.
You spend one-third of your life sleeping, so you should be comfortable. The original Casper mattress combines multiple supportive memory foams for a quality sleep surface with the right amounts of both sink and bounce. Casper products are cleverly designed to mimic human curves, providing supportive comfort for all kinds of bodies. Its breathable design helps you sleep cool and regulate your body temperature throughout the night. They're all designed, developed, and assembled in the U.S., and delivered right to your door in a small, how-do-they-do-that size box. You can be sure of your purchase with Casper's 100-night, risk-free, sleep-on-it trial. Get $50 towards select mattresses by visiting casper.com/Dana and using the promo code Dana at checkout. Terms and conditions apply.
Sizzling hot dogs, bursting with juicy goodness.
Make sure you get yours and enjoy it now.
like I feel like I listen to those people and it makes me A, feel good about what I do, which is not often the case, and that really inspire you. Like, who really inspires you? Well, obviously me. We'll take that.
No, that's a good, that's a good question, especially now, because I'm trying to, because when you mentioned Joe Frank the other day, it brought back up the memory of being like, kind of like, you know, one of my original inspirations. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like Joe Frank, like lifting me out.
Yes.
Of like some kind of, I think it's mental rut. And I think it's guys.
It's like the clouds part and the sun comes through and you're like, yeah, you can do something cool. He did it.
Yeah. Yeah. And again, it has to do, again, it has to do with, you know, you watch people take chances. You watch people not be linear.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Like I do.
They just go all over the place. They make it work.
I think you do it really well.
Really?
And I had a hard time doing it until I started doing your act on the road.
It's been different people for me, different parts of my life. I remember one part of my life where one of my biggest inspirations, and he's kind of turned into a right wing guy now, it was David Mamet.
Oh,
because
sure.
He was a genius
and he's become a cuckoo bird, right?
Yes. Yeah. I was super, you know, at one point I was really into, this play. I started studying acting and I was into this play called American Buffalo.
Yes, which not a lot of people know was originally about a buffalo and went through many, many changes.
Until it became three guys in a cheap junk shop.
Yeah, yeah. It was originally about...
That was after a lot of network notes. David, instead of a buffalo, is it possible we make the buffalo three small-time...
It was originally about a buffalo that picks up a frisbee in a field and can't eat it but carries it around with him.
Mm. I realized that one of the threads in like things that inspire me are like underdogs. Like one of the like for instance, like Mamet's American Buffalo and other Mamet plays that I liked. I'm trying to think of
Glengarry Glen Ross is probably Glengarry the most famous.
Too, but there was another one.
John McGinley was in Glengarry Glen Ross on Broadway.
John who?
John McGinley, John C. McGinley from TV Stand Against Evil. Yeah,
was he really?
Mm-hmm.
But like, they're all guys who are like the world is shitting on them.
Mm-hmm.
I loved Richard Pryor's. I loved Pryor growing up. Something really hit me. Like his characters, like Mudbone, the wino. Yep. And Frank's work has an element of that too, where these characters are like, you can tell that they are battling against immense forces.
They're people in pain.
They're people in pain.
Yeah. The Scott Alexander and Larry Karaszewski, the screenwriters, mm-hmm. their whole thing is like, they make biopics about people that aren't real heroes. About, you know, they make heroic biopics about Ed Wood and Larry Flint and Andy Kaufman. And, you know, it's like these aren't, you know, it's before that biopics were always Churchill, Charles Lindbergh. They make biopics about, you know, flawed, damaged people. And
my shit goes all over the place. Like right now, the last couple of years, I love a guy. Have you ever read, or I'm into audiobooks too, or heard Bill Bryson?
No.
I fucking love this guy, Bill Bryson.
Bill Bryson.
He did a book the summer of 19, it's either 17 or 27. I think it's 19.
You clearly really like him.
But he's amazing. Like he just, he like weaves in, like it's nonfiction.
Uh-huh.
And he just weaves in, you know, different time periods in America, like what was going on in baseball, what was going on with air flight, what was going on, you know, in the
That's
economy.
Really important. And I think people need to, because what's really important to remember is that things have always sucked and people have always been douchebags.
Amazing. Oh, he was talking about like
throughout human history.
Throughout
but
human history.
Specifically to this country.
The shit about, I mean, we're talking about, you know, I mean, everybody's talking about Trump now, but I believe it was, Herbert Hoover, and what a fuck up he was.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Like, just the main Wilson's life, Woodrow Wilson. Like, the more you delve into history, you realize that
we can't stop sucking our own dick because we claim we won World War II.
Yeah.
But when you watch Darkest Hour, you realize that, like, Britain was, hey, we're getting the shit bombed out of us. Yeah, we can't help you.
Yeah.
And Roosevelt wanted to help, but the great American population was like, we don't want to get involved.
Yeah, the isolationism.
We don't
want to
get involved. But it wasn't until
Europe's war.
It wasn't until they came over here and literally finally attacked us that we grudgingly became involved. And people, one of the big things that defeated Nazi Germany was that like 27 million Russians died fighting. You know, it's like
27.
Well, it was a lot. It was in the 20s, I think. Yeah, it's, you know, there was,
yeah, also this
500,000 Americans, 6 million Jews, and about 12 million Russians, or double that. You know, it was like, it's, yeah, the number is incomparable. And it was just because Hitler foolishly decided to also attack Russia, yeah, when he had him. You
the,
know, but
the
it,
scale of human catastrophe, death, cruelty is unfucking believable. World War One.
Oh, it's amazing.
The amount of deaths over World War One over small pieces of land in France is just fucking unbelievable.
Yeah, and then you take that into consideration, and then but we also live. It's so hard to get angry about Devin Nunes when you step back,
right?
And you just have to look at.
There is no perspective anymore. There's no perspective anymore.
It's such a clown show. It's such a fucking clown show.
It is such a clown show.
But has always been a clown show. And it's really, you know, it's, if you just listen to your radio and read website, and for on both, it, you really have to step out of it and go like, yeah.
The biggest,
like George Carlin said, when you're born into this world, you get a ticket to the freak show. And if you live in America, you have a front row seat.
Yes. Yes. And you might as well enjoy it.
Yeah.
But the biggest thing he hits in this book about, I'm such an asshole that I think it was 1917, is Lindbergh made the first transatlantic flight.
Right.
And what was amazing to read about was, I thought this whole thing about celebrity and fame was a new thing.
No, no, no.
Fucking Charles Lindbergh. And this was kind of hilarious. Charles Lindbergh, who eventually was kind of a Nazi.
Oh, no, but a huge anti-Semite.
Which is wild because he was the
I believe he was a Hitler apologist. I believe he was like,
yes,
give him a chance.
He was the quintessential American hero.
Yep.
This, the fame that whenever he would land anywhere, and so he was the first guy to fly over the Atlantic. He couldn't go anywhere without being mobbed. And it was absolutely fucking hilarious that he would just fly in town to town, and literally his plane would be, wherever he flew in, his plane would be swarmed with mobs. And he always was
people
like,
running,
don't touch the plane. He would be like, because it was kind of like, you know,
people gleefully running into the propellers.
or
it just looked like chili.
It was just unbelievable the level of fame he had in the parades. And he had, you know, fame fatigue. He was like,
oh, yeah,
I just want to be left fucking alone. Reporters outside his house all the time. So this fucking, you know, this sick celebrity culture that we live in. This shit started in 1917.
It's not, yeah, it's not new. It's not new. It's not new yet. Garrison Keillor is the king of National Public Radio storytelling. Like, he is the embodiment of that. And Joe Frank has his little niche, but you can't compare the two in terms of the quality. And I liken to, it's 1978 and you're Elvis Costello and you're looking at Journey and you're playing a little theater and Journey is playing Lake Erie. You know,
Exactly. You know,
there's a flotilla of people on boats to watch you play Lake Erie. And you know that you're better. And you know that what you do is of a higher quality. But for whatever reason, people just like, yeah, okay. There's a reason that, you know, vanilla is the most popular flavor. And did he shrug at that, or did it make him bananas?
It was more through like Ira Glass and This American Life where I think he felt that. And he talked about that in one of his radio shows. You
well,
know,
Ira
that.
Started, for those of you who don't know, and this is covered in the film a lot, Ira Glass and This American Life, Ira was inspired by Joe Frank by being his intern, correct?
Yeah, he was a production assistant. And I think years later, you know, in one of the monologues that's in the film, he talks about how, you know, he's busting his ass and, you know, has no sponsors and has no staff. And, you know, meanwhile, guys like Ira Glass and This American Life have, you know, they have it all cooking with gas and all the stuff's going on. And, you know, is it even worth it anymore, you know, working doing this stuff? Because, you know, other people who started behind him, you know, have it so easy, so to speak. And he's
sure.
Every week still trying to find an audience or a larger audience.
I can totally understand that, and to see how it would eventually make him nuts.
Yeah.
I think you get to a point where you realize, well, I do what I do, and that's it's once I record it, the reaction is irrelevant almost. It's like, I did it. It's done.
Yeah.
What year did you meet him and start working with him?
2010 was when he came through Steppenwolf to do the first show with Terry Kinney. The way that went down is they said it was cool for me to shoot it. I had a multi-camera, blah, blah, blah. Shot the whole thing. It was fantastic.
And what was that show?
Might be called Just an Ordinary Man or something like that, mm-hmm. or can't recall at this point. But it turned out great. He didn't want to do anything really with the live performance video I shot. But he had called me and said, hey, Terry wants to maybe shop this around New York or something like that. Can you cut together a scene from all the footage? And he said, I'll pay you for your production. I'll pay you for the scene and the editing. I was like, oh, Joe, listen, I can cut this stuff behind my back. This is like no big deal. I go, that's all fine and dandy, but what I want from you is I want the film. You know, I want to make a film. And he thought about it, and he said, okay, let's do it. And we talked about what that might look like and what he was interested in doing in terms of making a film. And that's how it all started. And so he did more live stuff that year, and that's when I think I went to L.A. the first time and interviewed him and some of the first batch of people that were part of his life. There were a bunch of people in L.A. and a bunch of people in New York. So then over the years, I would just... when I was in that area or that region, I would track down these people with the help of Michael and Joe, and they were all dying to talk about him, you know?
Right. And just so for the benefit of the audience, you know, who are some of these people that are talking about him?
Well, for me, it's like when you listen to the Joe Frank show, you'd hear him end it and he'd be like, you know, special thanks to David Rapkin and Arthur Miller and blah, 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 these people who would pop up, you know, in the shows. And so I knew I was really getting it together when I was meeting David Rapkin and meeting Arthur Miller, you know, or meeting Larry Block and, you know, then Debbie Mae West and David Cross did a little work with him. And then mm-hmm. Ira Glass and Grace Zabriskie as an actress and Ryan Catrona. Laura Esterman, who's based out east too, she had done a couple of great things with Joe. So these histrionic telephone calls and answering machines and stuff about saying how much she loved him and stuff. And then Larry Josephson, who's a great radio icon from New York. I think he was like one of the original drive time, you know, morning drive guys, you know.
And among his fan base, I met Joe when David met Joe. But also in his fan base, you have obviously Harry Shearer, who had a very popular show on KCRW at the same time, Le Show.
That's right. Alexander
and
Payne.
Alexander director. Payne. How did Alexander Payne, for people who don't know, the director of Sideways and many other films, did he work with Joe, or was he just a fan? How did Alexander Payne come into that orbit?
He was a massive fan, and I guess not similar from me. He was in college listening to him in Los Angeles and totally loved him. And I think his short film, he told me, was a total ripoff of Joe Frank in terms of, you know, a monologue that was sort of written over the top of it with the same sort of sensibility. So whatever his first short film was, that one was sort of like his homage, I think, or something, or at least creatively, to Joe. And then I think he always had him in the back of his mind. As a creative filmmaker. So
did he ever offer to work with him?
I don't know. I know that Coppola did, I think, and Friedkin and Michael Mann. And
didn't he go to college with Francis Ford Coppola or something?
He did. They went to Hofstra together. And I think they used to be pals. There was a famous story somebody told me on camera about how they got into a big snowball fight together and they used to get into little battles and stuff like that, you know, friendly stuff. I don't know if they kept up so much over the years, but they were always aware of what was going on in each other's lives and stuff.
What was the film that he wanted to do with you? Was it
Joe Frank's version of Swimming to Cambodia? What did he want to, did he have an approach to the film medium that was different than his approach to, that was specific in the same way that he approached radio?
Maybe so. I mean, he wanted to do stuff with him like driving around in cars and sitting in bars and getting into monologue stuff that maybe was a bit more theatrical, you know, or character driven in that way. And I think partially because of his mobility and stuff, as I started working with him, wasn't as good as he wanted it to be. And so some of those ideas we never even got into because, you know, he couldn't physically do it. We also talked, you know, about it being a lot more surreal than it turned out to be. There are like 20 scenes on the cutting room floor of different things that I've done over the years that were pretty extreme in terms of visuals or using cartoons and all sorts of stuff that didn't quite make it in the end. In the end, it just became, I don't know if I'd call it traditional, because once you start cutting Joe's radio shows into it, you know, the film can take on a life of its own. But, you know, it's pretty much driven by talking heads and waveforms and studio iconography and beautiful B-roll and stuff like that to sort of not get in the way of his audio. And that's the challenge with a film like this is, you know, you have to respect what he's saying. And the more weird-ass visuals I would put against it, it just distracts the viewer. And I think in the end, and you could tell
Me, you're using one medium to showcase another medium. It's like doing a show. It's like doing a documentary about painting.
Yeah, it sucks. You know, it's challenging, you know, and really all my years of doing filmmaking and stuff like that, you really are drawing upon all these considerations of how can we do this without getting, and I think, and you tell me, because I'm at a point now with the film where I'm so close to it, right? I can't feel it exactly yet, but I do, I get back to it, but I have a feeling it's like one of these films that has a lot of sensory overload to it. Like you get through it and it's almost exhausting because you are sort of listening to all this stuff with your ears and your eyes. And
I don't say sensory overload. No, it's exhausting, but it's, again, it's like his work. You're fully engaged. You can't put it on and putter around the house.
Right.
There's the brilliance of it. Like there are two huge radio people in Los Angeles that I'm just completely in awe of. And one is Joe and the other is Phil Hendry. And Phil Hendry, I don't know if you've ever known of him or heard about him. Phil used to be on KABC here in the 90s, and now he has his own show and a podcast. He's an actor and he worked, but there was a period of time in the late 90s where everyone in show business listened to Phil Hendry every night. I think it was 7 to 9 on KABC. And Phil would play his own callers. He had a radio show and he had 7 characters and they would call in and he would do it live with a telephone and a mic. He still does it. PHILHENDRIE. And he was technically brilliant, but what he had in common with Joe is that he was also a genius and his writing was gorgeous. And he would do, an example would be, he had a character named R.C. Collins, who was a 12-year-old kid from the Inland Empire. He talked like this, and he would be on the phone, and it would be a story of R.C. Collins, who was a Make-A-Wish child. The first-person story about what happens when you get involved with the Make-A-Wish Foundation. And he talked very, for the first segment, he would talk all about his illness and dealing with the Make-A-Wish Foundation. In the second segment, there was a problem, and that the Make-A-Wish Foundation wouldn't grant his wish, which was that he wanted to go to the neighborhood pub and drink a black and tan at the bar. And that was his only wish. And then people would call in like furious at this kid who's like, you're throwing your I'm sorry you're sick, but you could do anything and you want to, and he's like, yeah, have you ever had Bushmills? It's smooth as silk, baby. And people would go berserk. And every night for 2 hours, he would like run a clinic on how to structure a story and pull it out. And I'm amazed that both of these men, I think both of these men are geniuses. And why do I have to tell people about them? It's like, you know, why doesn't every, I feel the same way about Bruce Campbell. Why isn't Bruce Campbell, whoever the guy Thor is?
It's like, right, exactly.
You know, why can't he be, you know, how come all the people that I think are amazing, how come they don't break through to the giant, giant level of success that I feel they should? It's maddening to me.
Yeah. One guy's got the chainsaw. One guy's got the hammer.
Exactly.
What's the difference?
I remember a few weeks ago when I was presenting a financial summary for the restructuring of debt to leverage a corporate takeover, the executive vice president, an attractive woman in her late 30s, became entirely distracted. Her hands fidgeted, and she bit her lip as her eyes raced up and down my body. I could feel the heat of her excitement through her clothing. And then, suddenly, she tore open her blouse and skirt, the buttons cascading noisily on the surface of the highly polished conference table, and leapt at me. Her garter, having been caught on the underside of her chair, snapped her involuntarily back into place. But, undaunted, she crawled forward, dragging the chair behind her, and grabbed me by my ankles, her mouth flecked with foam, her eyes wide and wild, her hair matted with perspiration. She begged me, "Take me right here on this floor, now. Give me your strength, the cathedral of your love. I need the vast ocean liner of pleasure of which you are the captain. You have no idea how many nights I've thought about making love to you. I need you so badly. To hold back from me is to ruin my life. All I ask is for simple union, to be one with you. Let our coming together produce the kind of critical mass bound for an earth-shaking explosion that will release potentials never before imagined." I left the room because, as flattering as this sort of attention is, it distorts my life. It cheapens the quality of my existence. I can't even have a normal relationship anymore. Do I need to disfigure myself, take an acid bath, scar my face with a hot poker or a garden trowel? Once I went to a hospital ward of women who were blind. I did not speak, and yet my presence still created havoc. They leapt from their beds and crashed into walls, fell from their wheelchairs and lay writhing on the floor, reaching in all directions to find me, as though clutching for a life preserver thrown from the deck of a ship. I was forced to hide in a maintenance closet for 2 hours, until I was escorted out on a gurney, hidden beneath a pile of laundry, to a service exit. But I didn't escape unscathed, because once the orderly, a blonde intern, had successfully spirited me into the elevator, he leapt upon me and had to be pried from my body by a hospital administrator who proceeded to kiss me deeply, her hands fluttering like butterflies up and down my chest. I fled with my clothes in tatters. Sometimes, when I come home to my apartment, I look out and see rows of people in the building across the way, with binoculars, telescopes, video cameras, night vision enhancers, and parabolic microphones pointed in my direction. As soon as they see me, they become instantly animated. Can you imagine what it's like to see naked men and women dancing seductively and gesturing obscenely at you from their windows? Do you have any idea how awful this is? How my life has become a living hell? Oh, God, why did you curse me with such a gorgeous face, such good health and strength? Why have you given me so many admirable qualities? You test my faith on a daily basis. These gifts are unendurable. If only you could restore me as someone else, a slightly overweight, plain, balding, middle-aged man, needing dental work, with a mild skin condition and a post-nasal drip, a man of average intelligence, an indifferent lover with minor but nonetheless imminently pressing financial problems. For a while, I had my face bandaged as though I had been a victim of a terrible fire. I wore aviator glasses over the mummy-like gauze around my head, and wore gloves so that people wouldn't see the refinement of my hands, and stuck a pillow beneath my shirt in order to suggest I had a protruding gut, and wore an unkempt white wig, and affected a cane, and walked with a limp. And yet, in spite of that, I radiated an invisible energy I couldn't disguise, and was set upon by a crowd of strangers in the street who piled on top of me, kissing and hugging and caressing me. It's awful. It's demeaning. It's as though people are handling an object, not a human being, which I am. I am a person. I am somebody. I feel as though I must flee, hide myself, turn off the light, pull the covers over my head, and curl up in a fetal position, because I simply cannot go on any longer. It's too much to bear.
now. Every time I see you walk across the room, I can't bear it that you're not coming to me naked and ready for me. I don't know what I can say to make you want me back, but I just have to have you, and I have to have you now. Please, 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 Joe.
But we have like, that was before television.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It was amazing.
It's maddening. Yeah. And it's just.
We need heroes. I don't know what the fuck. We need heroes, or we need people to also, you know, put down like, look at that piece of shit. You know,
I think it's in a way, it's a bit, you know, we don't have in America, we don't have royalty.
Yeah.
You know, we celebrities became our royalty. Like, you have to have people that are larger than life to look at for entertainment value.
For entertainment value.
And then you have religion for emotional solace. Like,
right.
There's a, like, right. you know, you need,
where would Martin
people just like, my mother believes in, she has a guardian angel. A tiny woman in the nightgown floats above her. And helps her find her flip-flops. You know, it's like...
By the way, I used to laugh at that shit. Now, as I get older, I'm like, yeah, I get it. Where are my keys? Where the fuck are my keys?
Yeah, and it's a good... Because
you need solace. That's for sure.
You need solace.
And people kind of can let you down a lot. And here's the other thing. The famous saying, shit happens. Life is never fucking predictable. You think, okay, yes, it's all going well. You know, it's like, yes, oh yes, I see the order to the universe. And then the order is fucking, the rug is pulled out from from whatever it is.
Totally, yeah.
Whatever. I got plantar fasciitis the other day and I'm like, my life is fucked. Thank you, God.
What?
Do you know what plantar fasciitis is?
No, is it a foot problem?
Yes. Talking about Joe Frank's handicaps, it shouldn't be anything too serious.
In the course of human events, there's Rwanda, your plantar fasciitis.
We have an important announcement to make.
What is it?
No, it's just like a heel. It's like a heel spur. It's something.
Oh, a bone spur.
It's, and I don't even know.
Like our president. You have bone spurs.
The upshot is I have to lose weight, do exercises, all kinds of shit like that. Well, because there's too much weight
on your heel.
Yes, but it sucks. It sucks because it's kind of painful.
Is it like gout? Kind of.
Come on. You know, now, hey, I just want everyone to know.
For those of you who don't know, we should say that Ed and I do the podcast.
My podiatrist ruled out gout, but so that's good because that just sounds like one of those like mid ages, like.
Oh, my brother has gout.
1600 in England.
You get gout from too many martinis.
Yeah, so I don't drink and shit.
Yeah, me neither.
Red really, meat, yeah. I think. Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah, I you like know. A little. I like a little. I like a little red meat. I like I a little red do. Meat.
But I don't know how I got to plantar. Oh, yeah. I get wanting solace because life throws shit at you.
Totally.
From all over the fucking place.
Yeah. And it's hard to just, as Joe Frank said in one of his stories, if the law of nature is fang and claw, is human compassion an anomaly?
Yeah.
That's true. Yeah.
But that's also why I love his work so much, too, is that it mirrors life to me in a beautiful artistic way where it's like, oh, yeah, all kinds of crazy shit can happen. How old was he when he passed, by the way?
He was 80 or 79 or 80. Young, by today's standards, a young man. That's not enough for me. I have too much. I have to work my way through so many revenge scenarios. I need at least 100 years to work through my revenge plots.
Doc, you gotta. I need a blood transfusion because there's three more guys at CBS I have to get to.
My first girlfriend ruined my car. So I'm going to send her threatening letters to her work.
God, the amount of energy that goes into revenge. I was talking to a friend who's crazy, and he was just talking to me. I was talking to him, and he was setting out.
Friend who's
check
crazy.
This out. He was setting up dummy accounts on email to write Yelp reviews to undermine somebody. And I was just like, I can't even get my own podcast going.
Here's my question to your friend. I wish I had that kind of time.
Me too. When I get really busy, I kind of suffer from little panic disorder. How do you not feel overwhelmed? Do you just do one thing at a time?
I stay so busy. By the way, nothing I've described about myself is healthy. I stay so busy that I don't have time to go cuckoo bananas.
So you never kind of, and I don't mean this as an insult, reflect and go, like step back and go, because this is what I do that makes me crazy. I step back and go, fuck, I've got to do all this by Friday.
No, I literally, what I do instead of reflect, the last time I had time to reflect.
I don't have time to reflect. Imagine you as a philosopher, there is no philosophy from Gould. He was too fucking busy.
The last time I had time to reflect,
yeah,
what I did instead was I got all of my DVDs and alphabetized the discs into binders, but saved the cover slips.
Yes.
And put them in a separate file box.
So you just stay.
I have to do. I'm not a human doing. I mean, I'm.
Is there a part of you that goes, I'm a human. I am crazy?
Yes.
Is there a part of you that goes.
Totally. Yes. Yes.
Is there a part of you that goes, if I stop doing this, then Satan is going to rear its ugly head?
Yeah. Well, your brain is like a Pac-Man, and you know, if it runs out of dots, it just turns in on itself. That's my fear.
I think it's great though, because obviously, I need more of that.
Obviously, some of this is for comedic exaggeration. But
you go, and really let's call it
feelings,
doubt get into your fucking
brain. The hell I don't. Well, I just keep going. I just keep going. And it is one of those things where, I learned this too late in my career, but there are so many people that aren't that talented that act like they're fucking geniuses.
That's
and
so true.
And the business goes, okay, I guess you're a genius. And they go along with it.
They what is it that they I think that's why, like, swept away people who they're like rivers. They like sweep you into their fucking field.
Yeah, that's right. Well, there's a story, it's like, well, with women, like if you're kind of a schlubby guy, but you have just like a ton of confidence.
Yeah.
You'll end up with like a super hot girlfriend. Just people are,
and that's
going
that
on with
same, that's that same thing we're talking about.
Yeah.
It's like, well, he seems fine. You know, obviously this guy
knows what he's doing. Yeah.
Has it going on.
Yeah. It boggles my mind. One thing I've learned, there's certain things about like relationships that took me so long to learn. Mm-hmm. So long to learn. Mm-hmm. Yeah, things that you never, I don't know, what do you want to do? No woman wants to hear that.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, hey, I want to do this. I checked it out. It's great. Let's do it. This is another thing to say when you're planning a wedding. Never respond to anything with this. Oh, I don't care. No.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
I'm not planning a wedding. By the way.
But how are
you? I am a wedding planner on the side. That's my other. I have nothing against Chris Helmsworth or what he, sure, he's a lovely guy, but right. I'm those people, and they were so talented, and especially here in Los Angeles, where everyone is in show business and everybody is a storyteller or is involved in storytelling. I know when I was working on The Simpsons, everybody would drive home and listen to Phil Hendry, and the first hour the next day was talking about the Phil Hendry show that night. It was just that kind of impact. But Phil Hendry, you can have on and be doing stuff. You can put Phil Hendry on and make dinner and laugh and talk to your wife. Or you can, you know, you can be in the car and Phil Hendry on, you can talk to whoever's in the car with you. With Joe Frank, not an option. You are right. Listening to Joe Frank. And I actually think that it's something to do with the music. The thing that keeps you listening to him is that loop. And I, it was right. The strangest thing that happened to me. I was in the car with my girlfriend and we were listening to a story and it had the loop. And then we just started chatting about something and I couldn't, and it was like, I had to turn it off. Because I couldn't like tune it out. It had its hooks into me so deeply.
Besides having the drone to kind of introduce it all, they'd bring in the loops. And usually they're like 8 or 12 or 20 second sort of phrases that would repeat over and over again. So it was easy to hook into it. And I interviewed somebody about this. I think I ended up cutting it out of the film because it was just too
inside techy. Baseball?
Yeah, exactly. It was like, you know, they would take the analog tape and they'd actually tape it to itself and they'd string it all around the studio and it would be sitting on, you know, over on a mic stand over here and another mic stand here and then actually going through the recorder or the playback machine. And that's how he would do a lot of those loops in the early days, you know, before things were digital. And but that's part of it. It's just that sort of slow grind, you know, manipulative music, you know, which by the way is the stuff that I'm trying to clear right now in the picture. It's like part of the process.
As I told you on the phone when we first spoke, my friend made a documentary about the Wrecking Crew and the music rights. It was like, first you make the movie and then the hard part starts, clearing the music rights.
Yeah, well, we're doing a good job at it. We're finding nearly everybody, but it's getting there. It's part of the process of getting him out there in front of everybody.
And he had a pretty difficult row to hoe in terms of just his physical existence. Talk for a little bit about starting as a child. He was born with two club feet.
Yeah.
I don't even know how that is.
Yeah, he was born with club feet, and I think he even questioned whether or not he had club feet. In fact, some of his friends, he used to hide his legs from people. He had moved out to Great Neck, and they'd go swimming and stuff like that at the beach out there. I can't remember the name of it. And he used to cover his legs, and Peter, his friend, told me that you know, everybody's always really was wondering, like, you know, what's with his legs? It was like a super mystery. And then one day they finally, like, you know, he uncovered it to show his legs. And people were like, they're legs. There's absolutely nothing wrong with them.
What does club feet even look like?
I don't know. He did have an operation when he was very, very, very young, but he was always very self-conscious about his legs after that.
Yeah, from what I understand, he had an operation when he was 5.
Yeah.
And what he did not know was on the day of his operation, his father died.
Right. And then his mom withheld it from him and didn't tell him for a while.
Yeah. His mom said, your dad went away on the day of your surgery, which he didn't say was where he went, which was heaven.
That's right.
Which is mind boggling to me. And then his mom gets remarried. He takes the name of his mom's second husband, but he says he was indifferent to his stepfather and he didn't like his mother.
Yeah. I don't think his mother and his stepfather had a very healthy relationship either. And
I find that completely easy to believe.
Well, you know, I'll give away some more of the movie here. It's like, you know, one of the things he told me on camera that he felt like his first time he thought about his art and his work was he was sitting around the house one day and he heard his mom and his stepdad getting into a super violent, loud conversation. And he was listening from his bedroom and was completely alarmed by it. And took out a notepad and started writing down all the stuff. And he couldn't believe what he was writing. He told me that was the first time he felt like he could transform something like that into art. But I don't know if it was around that time or somewhere else. Or he had gotten kicked in the balls like in high school. And that turned into testicular cancer. And so that was like his next big health issue he had. And this was back when they had cobalt radiation treatment and stuff like that.
Well, first of all, not to take a deep dive into Joe Frank's balls, but one testicle was not descended and then it get kicked in the other one. And then that testicle develops testicular cancer.
Yep.
That's getting a blowout with no spare.
Well, when you talk about his health issues, that was the next big one that came down from, and then, You know, then he ended up getting bladder cancer.
So he manages to survive the cobalt radiation and the treatment without having to undergo a radical castration, which I guess is the only other option there. Just imagine facing that as a kid.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
And what that does to your psyche.
Well, what it did for him is it made him, I guess, a very serious person. He started thinking about writing and doing other things. At least that's what his friend told me. And then he had gone to, I believe, University of Iowa Writers Workshop and did a little bit of time there before he moved, got married and moved to New York. And I think he started working at Dalton shortly thereafter. But then he ended up going to D.C. from WBAI and did Weekend All Things Considered. And I think it was around that time when he was doing certain monologues, he was able to squeeze in and around those shows that Ruth Seymour from KCRW in Santa Monica found him at a radio convention and invited him out to L.A. to start doing that show and having all that creative potential that he had out there. And it was along that journey where he ended up getting bladder cancer and stuff like that in the 90s, I believe, and struggling through that stuff too. And then he had some other stuff later in his life also. So he always had, and I think we talked about this the other day. It's like, I remember listening to like In the Dark or Work in Progress. I guess it was In the Dark. And all of a sudden they were like, took him off the air. And I remember the announcer saying like, oh, he'll be back. He's battling with cancer. And I was kind of alarmed by that because here was this guy that seemed so
immortal and immortal, omnipotent. Right? Yeah. His right. voice alone was so powerful and hypnotic that for this guy to be ill at all, it was like, huh, what?
Yeah, I know. Well, I was on my 20s too, so everything, you know, you think you're gonna live forever anyway, but it's like, that was like, it was alarming to me to hear that. Yeah, he definitely had his challenges. I mean, right through to the end too. So tough life in that way.
Make love, Joe. I know it'll be right, and the hell with everyone else. I really want you so much. It's so corny to repeat the same thing over and over again, but how do you get the heart to speak? We can be strong men, strong, virile, vital men, clasped together, grinding together, working together, and whether I'm on top, as I would prefer, or you are, it doesn't matter to me, but we can talk about the details later.
I've been thinking about your body. I've been thinking about running my fingers through your hair and touching your face and just kissing that mouth and putting my fingers on your eyelids and holding you really, really close to me and having you hold me. God, I just, that's all I think about. I can almost feel the weight of your body on top of mine. And that's just, I've got to have it. I've got to have the real thing really, really soon. Or I'm just going to do something crazy in the office one day. I'm going to do something crazy.
Joe, I have to have you. I can't wait any longer. It's driving me insane. I have to have you all to myself. I can't let anyone else go near you. I can't stand it when anyone else touches you. I'm so turned on, I can barely walk. I can barely eat or sleep or think. I feel almost nauseated with love.
I was looking out over the quad and you walked by, talking to that other woman. And I saw you and I wanted to run after you and tear her away and take you back with me.
Just the idea of my head being crushed between your thighs and looking up at your face, you know, seeing your face from that point of view, God. I don't want you to laugh at me because, you know, until you try it, you'll never know what it's like. I mean, no one will love you more than I will from that position. Is it asking too much? Is it really asking too much? I don't think it is. What can be unnatural about anything that happens between two people when they're in love, when they're alone together?
For some time now, I've been thinking about you in ways I know I shouldn't. And sometimes after I talk to you or even to see you for a cup of coffee or whatever, I will go home and I'll just have to write in a to my journal, and my journal used to be about my life, and now my journal's about you. I just think about you. I think about what it would be like to do things with you, and I want you so badly. It's ruining my life. It's tearing my life apart.
I mean, when you sit down to write, do you just plow through the doubt? Because there's so much doubt in the writing process. There's so much, like, you know, you just hit that, hit that thing where it doesn't flow, and then you're like,
I have doubt. I don't have a lot of doubt. I'm very in my regular writing. I'm pretty, because of the process. I know it's just like, let me just get something down, and then I can fix it. Like, you know, I don't have a lot of faith in my writing, but I have faith in the process of rewriting.
Wow.
So I'm always, where I have doubt is with stand up. I always feel like I'm out of material, and I'm like, every,
that's pretty amazing.
Every
you
joke,
have a lot of material.
Every joke I write is my last. Every joke, like, God, I'm out.
Yes.
I'm out. We worked together on Saturday night, and I was not happy with my set. And,
yeah, I know you said that.
And I walked away thinking, like, I'm done. I'm done. It's all over.
It's such a fucking
by
delicate.
The way, this show will be preceded by me plugging gigs and then me going, oh, I suck. I suck.
The I'm done tour.
Yeah.
You just go out.
If you're a fan of The Walking Dead, come and watch my set. As I plaster on a phony, phony smile.
Let me ask you, getting back to our original topic, was Joe Frank prolific in putting stuff out?
His output, you know, he won a Peabody. His output was terrifying. But he was
By the way, we didn't talk about this a little bit. His music that he accompanied this stuff with is
brilliant.
So great.
And here's the other thing. Nobody ever just like nakedly copied him. Like what he did was so theft proof because
it was so unique.
It was so unique.
Someone asked me, oh, would you compare him to Spalding Gray? And no.
No, he would be like if Spalding Gray was entertaining. No, I like Spalding Gray, I did like Spalding Gray.
Me too.
But very tragic life. But I thought Joe was funnier.
Monologists and tragedies.
I know.
Joe was funnier.
Well, Joe wanted to live. Spalding committed suicide.
He got into a car accident that put him in chronic pain.
Is that what it was? Well, it's also
Spalding
his mother
Gray.
Committed suicide.
Oh,
and
right,
yeah,
right.
I think it was a hereditary thing. Mm. I think if he didn't kill himself, he wouldn't get an inheritance. It was part of his mother's will that he would get a lot of money if he killed himself. And then he thought, wow, this is great.
He didn't think that one through.
He did not think that one through. You can't play checkers. You got to play chess.
He
was very meticulous, but he only did that thing. Like
Frank?
He didn't.
Joe
like,
Frank?
Yeah, like I'm not comparing myself to Joe Frank at all. I am like writing a TV show and I'm writing a movie and I'm acting in a TV show and I'm getting my stand-up career and I have this little bobble, little audio bobble. He did recorded monologues with musical loops, period. Sometimes he would do them live.
I think he
wrote a book, but he did what he did.
Yeah.
And did it better than anybody.
Yeah.
And I think that's what also, it was just like he found what he did. Same with Phil Hendry. I mean, Phil Hendry, who's still with us and still creating.
I haven't listened to enough Phil Hendry.
Oh, well, I'll give you a couple CDs before you leave.
Okay.
Phil Hendry, fucking genius.
He's underrated. You don't hear that much.
Both of those men are criminally underrated.
Why?
Criminally
now,
underrated.
Let me ask you this
question. Because you got to be smart to enjoy them.
Is that the answer?
I think so. I do.
I was going to say, why the fuck?
It's just like it's an acquired taste. Maybe it's because we're both professional comedians, so our sense of humor is pretty rarefied or specific. It's like, when you meet like – there was a great headline in The Onion that said 450 record store managers injured – at roof collapse at a Yo La Tengo concert. It's like the only people that would go to see Yo La Tengo are people that managed a record store.
Right.
I fear that that's what like comedy is like for me, that because I do it, I'm immersed in it, it's so specific. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't have to be highbrow. It just has to be pure.
Yes.
The campfire scene in Blazing Saddles is as funny as it gets. Mm-hmm. And it's just people farting. But it's people farting smartly. It's true.
Yeah.
What was the last comedy that you laughed at?
I don't know.
Yeah, I know.
I don't know.
I know.
I haven't seen...
What was the last comedy you went to?
That's a good fucking question too. Why is that such a hard question? What's the last comedy?
Well, you're wearing a bridesmaid's t-shirt. So that might have been the last one I left it.
Is it?
I liked Bridesmaids a lot. I thought Bridesmaids was really funny. I think the last this is my limited view because I don't really watch a lot of comedy because
me neither.
It's my work.
Right.
But the last comedy that I saw and I walked out and I went, that was great.
Was?
Superbad.
Superbad.
That
was a long time ago.
Yeah, it was like 15
right?
years ago or whatever it was. God. But I like walked out of that going, that was great. As a was comedy. Like not the last movie that I thought was great. But like the last comedy, mainstream comedy, I was like, that was great. And then I saw like, I thought Things We Do in the Shadows was great. The horror comedy.
Shadows?
Yeah, that was a comedy. I thought that was great. It was directed by the guy. It was a part of Flight of the Conchords. It was about a group of vampires living in a house. It was directed. The director went on to direct Thor Ragnarok.
I get into different people. Like I went through a Steve Coogan phase.
Amazing. Yeah. Well, The Trip is amazing.
The Trip is pretty amazing.
Yeah, The Trip is amazing, and Alan Partridge is amazing. I would love to try to do that,
a Joe Frank type thing.
Yeah, that would just to see if you could, but it would would be stealing.
Right, that's true.
I wish I could do it in stand up. Like I would love. I was driving down Sunset, and they've painted Tower Records is closed, and Tower Records has been closed for 20 years
to be?
Now.
I forget. Now.
Well, the building is painted. With the sign on it now. And I think...
Where is it exactly?
I think it's painted for the show I'm Dying Up Here. I think that's why they painted it. It's where it always was. It's right across the street from Book Soup.
Oh, it's over there.
Yeah, it was where it always was.
Okay.
And I'm wondering... Mm-hmm. And it's painted there. As if it is still open. And I think it is painted as if it is still open for a TV show. That takes place in the early 70s. I think it's painted like that for I'm Dying Up Here, which takes place in that neighborhood in the mid 70s, which at the time we thought was a shitty time period. And we looked towards the time period that we are living in now as if it would be great. When in fact we are living in this time period now and think it's crap and look back fondly on that time period that we at the time thought was worse.
Yeah.
And to that, we added there was a seagull on the roof, which seemed to me very lost. And I thought there was something poetic in a seabird far from the ocean on the roof of a building that was closed, but was painted as if it was open. It was just like this beautiful, everybody here is a lie. And I just thought there's got to be something to that. But yeah. I don't think you could do it in a stand-up context. It's just too...
I feel like, you know, that's when I feel like stand-up is limiting, when you just feel like, well, sometimes, or a lot of times, you feel like, well, the audience just won't go on this ride with me.
It's very skilled. And then you go into a situation where they will, like if you do a, quote, one-man show, quote,
yes,
in a little theater, and yes, they will go on the line. But I think that 87% of that stuff is bullshit. You know, that just seems like so much of that is not funny stand-up.
Yeah.
Ruth Seymour is a big person in his story. You know, he's just a guy scraping by. He's at a convention. What's it called? The third?
Well, I don't know if it was that Third Coast Audio Festival where they met. I'm not sure, but
he was discovered by basically Ruth Seymour, who runs KCRW, right, which is, again, you know, it's the national public radio station in the heart of Los Angeles. It's a huge market, and KCRW in the world of NPR was a pretty radical station. It was the wild, you know, it was a lot of, you know, they had Harry Shearer was on KCRW, and they had a pretty daring approach, if you can say the word daring in association with NPR, which I know in and of itself is a struggle sometimes. And to be this completely, to go from this relative obscurity to be like the most galvanizing thing in the radio in the show business capital of the United States, because of this one woman going, yeah, you do it. And then they had a terrible falling out at some point.
Yeah, I think somewhere, you know, towards the end of his career there at KCRW, we talked a bit about in the movie that Joe wouldn't maybe confide in her with all of his different health issues that he was having in and around his schedule or his work and stuff like that. And I think she took offense to it. And that sort of added up to her being mad about the miscommunication with him and then firing him. But then later she sort of confided that it was because she thought he was played out creatively. So, yeah, he was really pissed off about that. But, you know, years later, he was invited back, and he did the Unfictional series and stuff like that. So
was she gone by that time?
Oh, yeah, she was gone by then. But I think between then, too, he did a lot of live stuff. You know, he was going out and starting to do things, the live stuff at Steppenwolf and things on the West Coast. And then, you know, he started doing online shows, too, towards the end of his career.
And I totally missed that. Like, he apparently... This was right around the time that I became a parent, not a parent, a parent. And I kind of stopped following things. He had this tremendous Facebook online presence that I was wholly unaware of.
Yeah, no, there's a big resurgence of people who, you know, they were able to track him down, and he had tons of fans. And it's the point we were talking about earlier. You know, there's a lot of people who really... You know, once they heard Joe Frank, they never forgot him. And it was kind of bittersweet when he did die in January, and you saw these really wonderful articles written about him, you know, about his legacy and stuff in radio. And, you know, and then you'd read the comments underneath. Wow, this sounds like a great guy. First time I've heard him. This guy's fantastic.
That's exactly right. That is the maddening thing, is that 9 times out of 10, when you talk about him, you're telling people about him. How doesn't everybody know about him? Why do people listen to 40 minutes of Lake Wobegon? One of the ones that really tried to make that leap, and I don't think it was intentional. Have you ever seen the Carlin special, Life is Worth Losing?
Probably not for a long time.
It was after his wife had passed away.
What year are we talking about?
Oh, God, I don't know. Early aughts.
Oh, okay.
His wife had passed away, and he was clearly in the midst of a giant depression.
Yeah.
And the set for the show was night in a snow-covered graveyard.
Oh, shit.
And the entire show was about death and dying and the futility of existence.
Where did he do it?
And the hideousness of man. I think at the same theater in New York where he'd done a bunch of them.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And it ended.
The Beacon.
The Beacon. And then it ended with this like 11-minute riff on people coming back to Earth from heaven. And it really is like a long form thing.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't know how to describe that special, because it's not, I actually talked to Kelly Carlin about this. It's not really a comedy special. It's something else.
Yeah.
And that really is one of the few things that seemed to me to straddle the line between sort of like a long form monologue and a one man show, but lacking the theatrical pretensions of a one man show. And I say that as somebody who has done one that was as pretentious as all get out.
Your Insomnia one?
Yeah. That was the best version of, I did a hour and a half one man show called Insomnia in the early 90s, following, it was the story of what led to me having a nervous breakdown.
Yeah.
But I was, at the time, I was in my late 20s. So, is that really a nervous break? Well, I was pretty fucked up.
I think so. I was pretty,
I was in my late 20s. I was pretty fucked up. But the show was an hour and a half.
Right.
The best. That's my dog is masturbating. Whenever I talk about how sad I am, my dog immediately goes into a triggers him.
He hears Insomnia one man show and he's like,
"Oh yeah,
I'm gonna bust a nut."
Yeah, he just wants to be Mike Birbiglia's dog. And he's stuck with me.
Oh, that's hilarious.
But I did it. So we used to do these shows in LA called Uncabaret.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. On Sunday nights at Luna Park in West Hollywood in the early 90s. And that was me and Janine and Kathy Griffin and Eddie Kindler and David Cross.
Were they just stories?
It was the premise. It was what became known as the alternative comedy scene.
Ah.
And Beth Lapidus was the name of person. That produced the show and started the
show.
It's
still going on.
She still does it. God bless her. In the early 90s, it was me and Kathy Griffin and Andy Kindler and Janine Garofalo and Bob Odenkirk and David Cross and all those people. And the premise of the show basically was you couldn't do anything that you had done before. You had to do new material, basically. And it worked and it lent itself towards being experimental and doing stories. I was never better on stage than I was when I was really under the gun there to come up with something.
Yeah, there's something about that.
Yeah. Having to meet a deadline is important.
Yeah.
And I did one night when I was recovering from this first kind of crack up that I had. I went on stage there and just sort of told the story. I didn't really write it up. I mean, I did bullet points of it. And I mean, enough time had gone by that I was functional again. And I didn't really.
I had a similar nervous breakdown.
Yeah. And
where I couldn't sleep either.
Oh, yeah. Well,
and I don't mean to one up you, but mine involved fantasizing about killing my dad and I would stare at a kitchen knife.
Oh, that's a good one.
So, folks,
I'm listening. Call in.
Could you please email us? And let us know which nervous breakdown you think was better.
Better, yeah. Mine was sexier. But one night I went on stage at Uncabaret and I just kind of told this story.
Yeah.
And Joe Frank was in the audience.
Oh, shit.
And said, would you do that for the show? And I was like, huh? No, I don't think you understand. That wasn't a performance. I was just, I couldn't get to therapy today, so I did it tonight.
Did you tape it?
It was an episode of In the Dark. It was, and I went in to KCRW and he.
I didn't know he had guests. He had
guests. Yeah. Oh, he had lots of guests. He had lots of actors. David Cross did a million In the Darks and he saw us all. He came down Cabaret and pulled a bunch of us out of there. Wow. David Cross did a lot of great stuff on In the Dark.
Are they archived?
Yeah, they're all archived. Cool. David did a lot of amazing stuff. And a guy named Larry Block, who's a friend of that, yeah. And so I went in to do it, and with the story, and he just kept going flatter, flatter. Like I would articulate, I would perform it, and he would go flatter, flatter. And in my mind, I'm thinking, dude, I know what I do. Dude, I know how I'm good, baby. And it was I think the best rendition of that experience that I did. I did a one man show about it.
Yeah.
And
it's interesting how
I think it was the best version of it.
It's interesting how in that medium, just don't push it is the message. It's like just kind of,
it took,
I don't know,
me
let the word, like
4.5 decades to figure that out.
Me too, man. What is,
yeah,
that?
It's the same with acting. Just like finally, yes. I got an acting teacher that just said, stop acting. Just stop acting.
Yeah. Well, I was told that also, but it didn't happen until.
No one has ever said that to William Shatner, oddly. Yeah, I think.
I didn't know you took acting classes, by the way.
Oh, it is. Yeah.
On and off?
On and off, yeah. Leslie Kahn is a genius. And
Roy Cohn for me.
Roy Cohn? It was, yeah, also your lawyer.
He was also my lawyer.
When I got cast on Mob City,
oh, right,
which was a, you know, a real show. Do you know Todd Stashwick?
Yes, I, yeah, do. He's a good actor.
He's a really good actor. And I called Todd and I said, mm-hmm, how did you do that? Because he's a comedy guy that
I know
plays a lot of serious roles.
He's an improv guy.
Yeah, Chicago guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then I knew him in New York.
Yeah.
And then, boom, I saw him do a couple of TV things that were really good.
Yeah, and I called him. I said, how did you get to that place? And he just went, Leslie Kahn.
Wow.
So I called Leslie Kahn.
Is she real good?
Yeah. Hey, scary good. I mean, like, fixed me in a day. I mean, didn't.
Now that's sufficient.
I still went with it. But what I mean is, yeah, I went in and she goes, let's do a scene. So she gives me a scene. And I started and 11 seconds in. Let me stop you right there.
Get out. Get out of my studio.
Amazing. She said, you're going to be really easy to fix because you're doing everything perfectly wrong.
Wow.
And it was just like 180 degrees. It was just like everything that you're doing external is internal. And I could get the algorithm of that. Like I understood the algorithm of that. And then it took me doing what I thought sucked.
Yes.
And then seeing that it was working.
Yeah. Would you tape it and look
at
it?
No, I would just literally, like,
you
when we were doing
it.
Mob City, like I would, couple of days, I was like, I don't think this is good. But then you do the take and the director comes in with notes and you don't get one, which is what you want.
Right. I know.
And it's like, oh, it's that.
Yeah.
Oh, it's negative 10. I was doing positive 10.
Yes.
You know, that's really what she, and it was, it's just having the, and it comes from being a stand-up comedian, and especially being a stand-up comedian that started off in Boston, where to get the audience's attention, you had to go into the audience and put on their clothes. You know, you had to, Kenny Rogerson used to say you'd be on stage, people in the front row are welding, and the table next to them is two bikers fucking a dog, and they're threatening you to not make the dog laugh. Don't make the dog laugh.
It's,
that's what it was like starting
true,
out in Boston.
It's true that doing stand-up is kind of antithetical to acting.
It's the complete opposite. People always think if you're a good comedian, you'd be a good actor. Mm. One is about talking and one is about listening. They could
one
not
is
be
about
more
talking
different.
And one is about listening, yeah.
Yeah.
There were rare guys who were but Gleason was not a stand-up. I'm thinking of Jackie Gleason. He was a big, broad comic actor.
Yeah.
But he did some dramas that he...
Yeah, I think Gigi was it, or it was like a...
Gigi.
Yeah, or something like that. Gigo, it was, I believe it was...
The Hustler?
Mm-hmm.
With Gleason?
Yep.
He just had this gravitas.
Yeah.
Well, Pryor also could act too.
Oh, he was amazing. Yeah. He was, yeah. And they were not both guys. I'm assuming, I don't know much about Jackie Gleason, but I'm assuming both of them painfully damaged people.
Oh, well, yeah. We know about Pryor, but Gleason too. I'm
assuming.
Positive.
I'm assuming. Oh, yeah.
Positive.
But it's the weird I've been thinking about it a lot, because when the news of his passing, I went back and started listening to all that stuff again, and I went back to that period of time when I, you know, in the early, when I first discovered him and was, and you know, yeah, was around, and it's amazing, because you think you know what your life is going to be. And I think back on what I thought my life was going to be back then. And although I have the same, you know, it's like, I couldn't have been more wrong, but, and this sounds really airy fairy, but it did work out. Like, I'm actually happier than yeah, I thought I would be. Like, you never, yeah, I don't think people without kids envision, you know, like, how, yeah, you can't know how having kids changes your life,
yeah,
until you have them. And I think that for me was the big like thing that I had totally wrong. And, you know, I thought I was going to be a giant star and all this bullshit. And, and it's amazing. Like, you look back like, yeah, no, I was completely wrong, but it didn't, it wasn't bad. What happened wasn't, it was just not what I thought.
Yeah.
It was really, but you can't, yeah, you can't, it's hard to
which
get
is
to
such
that
an
place.
Element in Joe Frank's work. Like, I was listening to a piece before I came here today, and it was like, it was a monologue about my ex showed up, and, you know, she said, "I can't believe you slept with that slut." And I wanted to say to her, but she has a degree from Princeton in archaeology. And do you know the one I'm talking about?
The Perfect Woman. The Perfect Woman, I believe, is a perfect woman.
Oh my God. It's so funny. Oh,
it's amazing. It's amazing. And he just would.
He twists, like, he does a thing that really great stand-ups do, is, you know, the misdirection. It's like, you think, and it's, and, but it happens every sentence almost with him.
Yes.
Where you think he's going one way and it just takes a turn.
But it's a beautiful turn. The turn is exquisite. You know?
Yeah. And the turn goes into another turn, it goes into another turn, and then you're going up, then you're going down, mm-hmm, then you're going.
And I think one of the things that I also was very envious about him was that he did his work, and his mm-hmm work had great reach. Mm-hmm. But he was basically, his work took him from his house to KCRW and back. Like, he didn't have to drive to LAX at 5:30.
Oh God.
You know?
I have to do that soon.
Yeah. Don't we all, brother?
Oh.
Robin used to call it slinging hash.
Did he?
You gotta get out there and sling that hash.
Gosh, what the fuck it is.
Yeah. Where are you going?
I wanted to ask you, did he? You knew him. Did he write this stuff and then perform it? Did he sit down and write all these models? Because it has.
Are you talking about Joe?
Joe Frank. Does it have?
You're talking about Robin. Robin.
No. No, does it, because his stuff, his stories have this quality of
very scripted, very scripted.
Oh, okay.
And he
has a stream of consciousness feel.
No, incredibly scripted. And then he would edit them like a movie. Like, he labored over that stuff. He was so, that's why they're so brilliant. Like, he was obsessive about his work.
How
and then you could
would
hear
it take it to do a piece.
Oh, I think
any ideas?
I don't know specifically, but I know that they had to pry the work out of his hands. Like, it was like, no, we're going. It's going on the air.
Wow.
Yeah. It was amazing. He was great. There was a documentary about Dick Zanuck, the film producer, and it was called "Don't Say Yes Until I Leave the Room," or something close to that. And his father was Daryl Zanuck, who was the original, one of the original film moguls in Los Angeles, was the force behind 20th Century Fox. And I believe his memoir was called "Don't Say No Until I Leave the Room." And so his son's was "Don't Say Yes Until I Leave the Room," or "Don't Say Yes Until I'm Finished," or something like that. Long story short, there's a documentary made about him, and they screen it for him. And he says, "This is great. Good job." And he dies the next day. Basically, the same thing happened with this film, by and large.
Yeah, I mean, last year, we got down to brass tacks to finishing the film late in the summer or October or something like that. The biggest part of the deal I had with Joe with this film is he wanted to have final cut, you know, and I had to give it to him. You know, if you want to make a film with Joe Frank, what are you going to do? Say,
yeah,
fight that. I'm not David Lynch or anybody, so I can't.
Yeah. Win. No, you're not. Your film has an ending.
Right. Exactly. And so, you know, a lot of the process of with the film, it took a while for it to come together because I personally didn't have control over it to some extent till he said, this is fine. This is great. And he did. He saw it before he went to the hospital by like about a week. He had liked it and was happy with it and was looking forward to everybody else seeing it. And, you know, we talked at length for about it. What was cool about Joe is sometimes even when I was around him filming, it was tough to get personable with him because I think he liked to tease me or at least make me look like the bad guy who was bothering him with a camera in his face, you know.
Uh-huh.
People do. But I'd get on these phone calls with him over the years that would go for hours, you know, an hour, 2 hours. We'd be talking about the film or other things about life or whatever. And that was sort of like the last call I had with him. We spoke for about an hour about the film and reflecting on all the stuff like that. And
that's an odd conversation to have with somebody. I want to make a documentary about you. I imagine being on the other end of that conversation would be strange.
Well, like I said, he's kind of an intimidating guy, you know, so it's like part of my challenge was to sort of win that trust over the years with him, whether it was, I'll never forget, we'd been shooting for a while and I'd interviewed people a bit on the East and West Coast and I cut together like the first sizzle reel, right? Like, here's what it's going to be like, you know, here's a vibe, here's 12 minutes of action, right? And he didn't give me much feedback on it. I was like, thanks, got it. You know, I get the terse email, got it. You know,
right.
You know, come on. But all of a sudden I got an email from his friend Ryan Catrona one night. It was around New Year's, and I'll never forget. He's like, oh, my God, I just got off the phone with Joe Frank, and he can't believe this film. It's going to be awesome. Joe Frank likes your work. And he went on and on. And I felt like, wow. And Joe never really told me that at the time. So, but I knew that he was getting the style and what I was putting into it, he was receptive to. So it gave me a lot of positive sort of energy to move forward with it over the years or whatever when I was getting back to work on it.
In the last conversation, did he know he was sick? Again, did he know that he had fallen ill?
No. He knew he was going in for a major operation. I think he understood his body had taken a big toll over the years with all the different things that he had going on. And he had mentioned that to me. You know, he'd say, I don't know if I'm going to get out of this, but, you know.
What was actually, just for the sake of the...
Well, he had colon cancer at the end of the last thing. So he had gone through some operations for that. And so, but he's a resilient dude. And I think he showed that through the whole process. And you know, his wife, Michael, has been by his side for many years now, helping him, you know, maintain his career, maintain his health. And God bless her. She did a great job with him, I think, right to the very end, trying to, you know, work with him in the hospital and all that stuff. So, but yeah, that was the end, so to speak.
Yeah. Well, the good thing is, obviously, all of his work survives him. And I think in the long run, the documentary will probably be one of the things that leads people to his work. I think it's going to be one of the situations where people see the documentary and that's how they'll discover him. For people who want to see where it's playing or where it is, why don't you tell us how we can avail ourselves of Joe Frank somewhere out there?
Yeah, go to joefrankmovie.com. You'll see trailers on there. There's a little Indiegogo campaign going now to sort of get the last chunk of money for the music licensing. But in the near future, it's going to premiere, sort of world premieres at the Sonoma International Film Festival, March 22 and 23rd, two screenings. And then after that, it's going to be at the Wisconsin Film Festival in early April on 2 days, the 11th and 12th. So if you're in the Madison area, you can check it out there too. And then I'm, you know, we'll see what, as it goes, these festivals start picking it up. It'll all be on, you know, joefrankmovie.com. You can figure out how to track it down or contact me through the site and I'll be happy to share with you whatever's going on.
That's excellent. Well, thank you not only for making time for us today, but also for making the film. You got it in just under the wire.
I told him the last time I talked to him, it was a privilege. You know, I thanked him because, you know, this guy's a master, you know, and he's one of the true originals. So just being able, having the opportunity to make a film about him was great for me. Yeah.
Dave Carlson. Thanks, man.
My pleasure. Thank you, Dana.
And we're out. I'm really just going to use the part about his balls.
Thank you.
And this, if you're interested, is the piece Eddie and I were talking about. This is Insomnia from In the Dark, circa 1993, written and performed by me and produced by the great Joe Frank.
I grew up in a town called Hopedale, Massachusetts. My address as a child was 9 Cemetery Street. It was a long road, and at the very end was the town cemetery, Hopedale Village Cemetery. But Hopedale is the most ironic place anyway, because it is the most depressing town you can possibly imagine living in. It's this small mill town with these little duplex houses based around a large 4-square-mile loom factory that went out of business in the early 1960s. And so you have this idyllic little New England town, and at the very center is this rotting, cancerous foundry that just continues to fall apart. Everyone in my family, at one time or another, drank. Every adult I knew growing up drank. Everyone in Hopedale drank. When I became a teenager and my friends started to drink, every weekend I was faced with a simple social choice. I could go out and watch my friends drink, or I could stay home and watch my family drink. When I was in 10th grade, on the Saturday night before Easter Sunday, a bunch of my friends decided to go out into the woods with a couple of cases of beer, and I decided to join them. The cop who arrested us was a drinking buddy of my father's, Officer Sullivan, or Sully to my dad. Officer Sullivan called up my father and said, "Kenny, I've arrested Dana for drinking in the woods. Put one on ice for me and I'll bring him home when I get off duty in an hour." The next morning, my mother came into my bedroom and asked me what had happened. I told her that it was stupid, I was out hanging out with everyone, that I wasn't even drinking. My mother said, "Honey, if you don't mind, don't tell your father that you weren't drinking. When Officer Sullivan said that you'd been arrested, he was tickled pink. Let's just keep this our little secret." I have the worst insomnia in the world. I always have, because I was raised Catholic. When you're 6 years old, they teach you a prayer. "Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take." It's a wonderful thing to drill into a child's head. "Good night, son. Try not to die in your sleep." Because I actually thought as a kid that if I went to sleep, I could just slip into death. I'm a comedian by trade, and I had built a wonderful reward system in my life where the more miserable I would be, the funnier I would get. And when I discovered that by dwelling on the pain and the misery in my life, the more successful I became, I figured I'd just keep going. Maybe one day I'd have to get help. Maybe one day they'd just lower me down to the stage in a cage, I'd hurl some feces at the crowd, and they'd wheel me back up. Sometimes I would find myself looking at the people who live in the street. I'd pick out the most destitute soul I could see, and wonder how far I was from them. I'd have a little psychic tape measure that I would run from their forehead to my forehead and measure the distance. And it started to frighten me. On my way home every night, I passed the intersection of Highland and Fountain. And at about the middle of May of this year, a homeless person discovered that intersection. He was this balding man with a very thick black beard, and he would stand shirtless in the middle of the intersection and stare down the drivers. He never asked for anything. He never reached out his hand. He never looked you in the eye. I just saw him as this man who stepped over the line and was fighting this wave of traffic like a man fighting the ocean. He had reached his most primitive level of being, standing there, staring down all of society as it tried to rush past him and get onto Highland. And I noticed, as summer progressed, that he seemed to devolve physically and spiritually. In May, he stood there proudly, shirtless, bare-chested, Homo sapien fighting off a flow of traffic. As the heat of June started up, he slightly hunched over, and he began to resemble Java Man. His eyes would blink at the cars slightly. When July struck, he was further forward, Cro-Magnon Man, figuring out where he was, what was all this noise about. In the dog days of August, he was hunched halfway over, his hands resting on his knees, primitive Syngenthopus Man, thinking only of the foot or so of ground in front of him. I'm afraid that by October I'll be on my way home and stop at the light, and there'll be a small gibbon in the street hurling feces on windshields. Possibly by Christmas there'll just be a fish flipping in the road. Sometimes I wonder if I'll end up like him. And sometimes I wonder if he's Jesus, standing there, watching the cars drive by, no one offering any help, making tiny mental notes. My Aunt Jean is strictly devoted to Jesus. In fact, she has Jesus art in every room of her home, and in every single piece, he's bleeding. On the nightstand in the guest bedroom of my Aunt Jean's house, where I would sleep as a young child when I would visit, there was a life-size bust of Jesus hovering over the bed with the crown of thorns, staring at you as you tried to sleep. You'd look up from the bed and just see these two tortured eyes and this grimace of pain. One night, about 3 o'clock in the morning, I'm about 9 years old, I reach out in the dark to get a glass of water, and I impaled my hand on the crown of thorns. I called my Aunt Jean, and when she came in the room, she saw blood gushing from the center of my hand, and for a minute, she thought it was a stigmata. One day, I came home from second grade, and my Aunt Jean was at our house. She told us that She was staying there for the weekend because my mother had to go to the hospital. She wasn't sick, she was just tired. Later, I found out that my mother had to go to what my brother Kevin euphemistically called no sharp objects camp. When my mother came home from the hospital, she would sit in the living room in her white bathrobe, chain smoke Vantage cigarettes, and watch Oral Roberts. And I don't mean just watch Oral Roberts. I mean kneeling on the floor, hands on the screen, praying with Oral Roberts. But you can't watch Oral Roberts without sending him money. Out of every hour, he talks about Jesus for about 10 minutes, and the rest of the 50 minutes is a shill for donations. After about 40 minutes, they slowly lull the viewer into a state of hypnotic suggestion, and soon you are overcome with an overwhelming urge to become a partner in Oral's ministry. But we didn't have any money to spare. So my mother and I rigged up a plan where every Thursday night, she would take me to the grocery store to do the grocery shopping with her, with an envelope of cash that my dad had given her. And that was when my mother and I began shoplifting for Oral Roberts. We would shoplift a certain number of items and deduct their value from the final total and send that to Oral. 3 days later, you get a letter back from Oral thanking you for the donation, but could you please send more? So we'd have to steal more. And this continued until the one day my father came home and found a stack of Oral's thank you letters in a cupboard. He confronted my mother in front of me and my brothers and a couple of our neighborhood friends that were at the house. And I remember him screaming, "I don't know how the hell you're getting this money, but I know whatever you're doing, it's sick. And if you want to go to church, there's one down the street, and it's free." That speech my father gave my mother is longer than any conversation my father and I have ever held. But I would visit my family once a year as a sort of checking in. Sort of like elephants will return to the burial ground once a year to look at the tusks stick out of the mud. This year I went home for 4th of July weekend, and there was a lot of company staying at my parents' home. So much so that there were no beds available. My mother asked me if I would mind sleeping on the couch. And I did mind very much sleeping on the couch, because I am only home 4 or 5 days a year, and I'd like to sleep in a bed. So, of course, I said, "No, I don't mind sleeping on the couch." And then I went into the living room, turned on the TV, and ate a bowl of pretzels like it was a handful of nails. So I would stay up until about 2 in the morning, go to sleep on the couch. At 4:30, my father would come downstairs, turn on the lights, wake me up, and I would go upstairs and go back to bed in his bed. My mother sleeps in a separate room. And this bizarre nighttime ritual went on every day I was there. And every day, without me realizing it, I was getting angrier and angrier and angrier. The last night I stayed there, I was so angry I did not sleep until 4:30, when my father came down, tried to wake me up, and I jumped off the couch and nearly gave him a heart attack. I went back up to his room and stared at the ceiling. At noon that day, I flew back to Los Angeles. I had a lot to do. I was moving to a new apartment in 3 weeks. I came home that night, got in my bed, and couldn't sleep. I didn't know why, but I couldn't sleep. The next day, I figured the reason I couldn't sleep was my body rhythms were thrown off from all the travel. So I went to my acupuncturist. She said, "How was your trip home?" And my throat tightened up. "Dana, how was your trip home?" And I said, "I can't answer that or I'll start crying." She said, "Well, you have to." And I cried for literally an hour and a half. Violent gushing from the abdomen. Vomitous crying. Her husband is a very strong, physically big man. Picked me up and held me like a child while I bawled. And I figured, thank God I've had that catharsis and now it's over. So I went home and I didn't sleep again. So I went to my therapist, who said that my inner child was angry and I needed to dialogue with my inner child. So I started to dialogue with my inner child, and my throat tightened up, and I started crying, and I kept crying for another hour of gushing, regurgitative sobbing. On the third day, I realized that I was terrified of being alone in my apartment at night. So I stayed with a friend of mine, a girl named Karen. At her house, I passed out for about 3 hours and felt like things were getting better. On the fourth night, at Karen's, I didn't sleep. During this period, I was supposed to be preparing to move, but I was so tired, I couldn't do anything. So every time I would go home, I would be surrounded by these things that I had to do that I couldn't do. And at night, I'd go to Karen's, think about them, and not sleep. By Saturday, I realized that I had been awake for 55 hours straight, and I thought that I was dying. And the measuring tape between me and the guy in the intersection was really, really short. It was Saturday. I had to be in my new apartment on Monday. They were shutting off the power where I was living the next day. And all I could do was sit in the living room floor and hyperventilate. I realized that I was really losing it. My apartment was a filthy mess. Half-eaten plates of food, videotapes, CDs lying around, clothes everywhere. I had this one t-shirt I bought in Seattle at the Sub Pop record label store. And on the back of the shirt, it said Sub Pop Records. And on the front of the shirt, in big letters, it said Loser. And I always thought it was so funny. I wore that on the plane the day I went to visit my parents. Something inside me wanted me to show up at their house with Loser written across my chest. I was on the floor and I spotted it, and I picked it up, and I walked down to the beach and, crying, ripped it up and threw it into the ocean. I called my managers, this Australian couple who handle my comedy career, people who had no idea that anything was wrong at all, and told them that I had been awake for 55 hours. I was incapable of operating an automobile. I was going insane, and that they had to come and take me to the hospital. They bring me to Cedars-Sinai, and I'm wheeled down to the psych ward. They brought in a psychiatrist. We spoke for a while, and he told me that I was suffering from displacement anxiety, and that my body had lapsed into a state of somnambulistic hypervigilance, that I didn't feel safe, and my body wouldn't let me sleep. He gave me some pills called Xanax, told me to go home, get some sleep, move into the new apartment, reestablish a home. But the admitting doctor would not let me leave the hospital and go home alone. So I was remanded to the care of my managers. My managers bring me back to their home, where they have two 2-year-old twins. They pull into the driveway, open the door. These two identical red-haired, blue-eyed kids come screaming and giggling up to their parents. I step in the door behind them, and these two children stop dead in their tracks, like two deer in the headlights of a truck. But I take my pill and I go to sleep. And I think that everything is going to be fine until the next night, when I take my pill and I don't sleep. I drink a glass of wine, which you're not supposed to mix with the pills, especially when you don't drink. But I figured it would knock me out, and I didn't sleep. It's 5 a.m. I've got 10 milligrams of Xanax in me, half a bottle of wine. The sky is beginning to gray into early morning. I'm wide awake, and I'm convinced that by the end of the day, I'm going to be at the intersection of Fountain and Highland, fighting that guy for a space. But instead, I pick up the phone and I call my father, with whom I've never had a conversation, and told him, "Ever since I visited you, I have not been able to sleep. And that there are things that I've been wanting to say to you for 30 years that I'm going to tell you right now. Because I don't want to say these things at your grave. And my heart stopped dead in my chest, waiting for his response. And he made the decision to be a father and ask what was wrong. And I told him everything that was wrong. Starting from my trip home for 4th of July, back to when he missed my little league game in 4th grade. And he did something I've never known him to do. He listened. And he talked to me. And he cried. And came out of his shell as far as he was capable of coming out. We were on the phone for about an hour and a half. And then he put my mother on the phone. And we had a very similar conversation. I told her everything. From the trip back to as far back as I could remember. I just cleared the slate out. After about 3 hours on the phone, everyone was pretty wrung out. I told my mother I loved her. She told me she loved me. And then, for the first time, I told my father I loved him. He told me he loved me. I went upstairs and took a nap. A few nights ago, I was in my car driving through Hollywood, thinking about what I had been through in the past month. And I realized that after 30 years, I had finally connected and become a member of my family. I pulled up to a red light, and I noticed that I was at the intersection of Highland and Fountain, and there was no one standing there.
Other podcasts reach for the sky. Dana Goldbound.
We barely try.
This has been the Dana Gould Hour, brought to you by the Internet. Music by Andy Paley, with Jake Posner behind the board. Produced by Jeff Fox. Graphic design and web production by Spencer Hunt and Segan Friend. Sound editing and post-production by Jalinda Palmer and Joe Napolitano.
Hey, if you like the show, why don't you drop us a line at show@danagould.com. Tom Kenny speaking.
I'm a DJ, I'm a DJ, I'm a person, I'm a person. I'm a singer, I love to sing and DJ. Boom! Peace out. You want me? Peace out.